The opinions expressed in this program are not those of CISA 7 or Time Warner Cable.
First, I'd like to start. We have our public forum. Yeah, this is a time for members of the community to speak before the board about anything that's of concern. I have one person who's registered to speak before the board, so I'll call Karen Stibbs and Julie Pitton are coming up together.
Okay, my name is Karen Stibbs and I am an AFSCME representative. I live at 2690 Regina Street in Green Bay. And I'm back again tonight to just reiterate the concerns that we outlined at the meeting on January 12th and then also with a follow-up letter to the Board of Education and members by our AFSCME representative, Mary Schoon. We are still advocating that the language in the handbook remain the same until the district and the school board develops a process that we feel and everyone should feel is efficient and timely. While we know that the board makes the final decision whether the job posting language is revised, we are asking that the language remain unchanged until the process that is adamantly not being followed be sorted out. If the process currently in the handbook is followed as stated, the district may find there is no need to make such substantial changes. After all, this is the language that we all collectively approved when the employee handbook was developed. Also, we still think there is a need for two separate languages in the employee handbook for filling job vacancies for exempt and non-exempt employees. There is not a one-size-fits-all language for this process. The two employee groups are just too different. Last week we met with Gene and Randy at our monthly meeting and Michelle Langenfeld was kind enough to appear and talk with us. She commented that seniority counts and that employees should have a leg up when being awarded vacancies, to fill vacancies. And we just want to know how this will be monitored when we are competing with outside applicants simultaneously for filling job vacancies. And also in reading one of the a memo dated November 25th that I think accompanied the handouts that went initially before you for this proposed language, with the 5-day trial period being eliminated from the handbook language. And if I can just read this, because I don't expect that you'll have this memo on you right now. It says the 5-day trial period will be replaced by an optional job shadow. If an employee transfers to a position that is not a good match and they wish to return to their previous position, we will work with them to facilitate a move to a more suitable position. Well, when I think about the definition of a job shadow, and I know that it's practiced in all levels in the district with teaching staff, paras, and right on down the line, I find that a person would go to a work site and work simultaneously with the person that's already holding the job and learn from them, whether it be just a couple hours, a half a day. But if the job is vacant, who are you going to job shadow with? There's nobody there to job shadow you. And it's also kind of disturbing that, well, it kind of sounds like we're not going to get our previous position back if it doesn't work out after a job shadow. It says that they will facilitate to move you to a more suitable position. I don't understand that. So if anybody has any comments on that, I'm a little worried about the replacement language that will be in the handbook, or the intent that it will be practiced when the 5-day trial period language is removed, or if it's removed from the handbook. Also, at the meeting last week when we met with Randy and Jean, the AFSCME units were agreeable with using the WECAN system to electronically apply for jobs. We think it's a more efficient and timely way to do things. But we also brought forward the concerns that several of our support staff groups, and I'm using maintenance and the monitors and the new and hour supervisors and cooks, quite frankly, that don't have access to computers for a large percentage of their day, that they're a little leery about using the WECAN system. So we're going to advocate for some training in the WECAN system. And we also have a lot of questions about the air checking and the way the WECAN software works. And I believe that that's going to be an agenda item on the Labor Management Committee meeting that's scheduled for January 28th, correct? Okay. Another concern of ours was that the district said they were going to discontinue emailing job vacancies internally using the employee email system and post everything directly onto WECAN. And we found this to be a little troublesome when we're required to get on WECAN every day just to see what's new for the day. So in our meeting again last week with Randy, Jean, and Michelle, we thought that we could live with this if jobs were posted on a agreed upon day of the week, where if you know on Fridays or on Tuesdays of the week, you could log on to WECAN and see the job openings that are available on that certain day. And then I would think from your perspective that all those jobs, the job postings would expire at the same time. So you're not, from your working standpoint, you're not always looking every day and processing every day too. The same 5 days runs for all jobs. So I hope that is considered and will move forward as we suggested at that meeting too. So when we talk about the employee handbook language and moving forward with potential changes, additions, revisions, I was of the impression that the district was interested in talking with support staff groups, teachers, paras, and maintaining a transparency with employees when developing the handbook. And this time around with this set of proposed changes to filling job vacancies, didn't quite see that happen. So we're a little concerned about how future changes will be handled. And we're recommending that you still use the employee handbook committees to discuss and make any recommendations. Okay, that's all I have, Julie.
I'm just following up. This one's on. Can you guys hear me okay? Okay. I am also filling in with AFSCME Council 40. The board members should have received a letter from Mary Schoon following the last board meeting, which did detail a lot of these concerns that our members have had. Just following up on that, I was the staff rep that was here in between Randy and Mary, who sat in on many of those handbook meetings when we did have that dialogue and back and forth, and have consistently heard and still helping out and volunteering with these folks over and over, is that the district always does say, let's be collaborative, let's be cooperative, let's get all ideas on the table. And we've always respected that position. But now all of a sudden it does feel like decisions are being made behind closed doors and we're saying, oh, sorry, here's what's gonna happen. Now, does that mean that we're always gonna agree? No, and sometimes we're gonna have to agree to disagree. And we're okay with that. We're not saying that we need the final say or that HR should have the final say. But I think what's really disheartening and it's really affecting morale across the board is that it is coming down to all of a sudden that this is gonna be the better solution and this is what needs to be done. Should the board feel that that's the way we need to go? That's your prerogative, but we do ask that you at least sit down with the employees and hear their experiences and hear what has worked and what hasn't worked. So that being said, Mary Schoon is still the staff rep. If you guys have any questions for us, you guys all have her contact information. If she's covering a lot more territory these days, so I'm able to fill in when need be. So if you have any questions, let us know and we'll be happy to respond back.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who would like to speak before the board? Seeing none, then we will move on to our agenda, and I will turn this over to Katie Maloney, who will facilitate our teaching and learning work session.
Thank you, Brenda. think we're all set. That was a good pre-run to make sure the microphones are working. Good evening. Offer a little bit of the opening context here to the presentation, and then I'll have Mike and his team take over. This evening, we have the opportunity to come to you asking for consideration to approve curriculum in the form of content or course essential documents, along with professional learning and associated resources. We have several areas that we're going to cover: Chinese, family, consumer, science equivalency, agri-science equivalency, and English language arts. Leading the presentations is going to be Mike Fries and Nancy Chartier, the directors of teaching and learning for both the elementary and the secondary level, and they'll have their curriculum coordinators or our teacher leaders as part of the presentations as well. Before Mike takes over, I just wanted to offer a little bit of the context to the first item that you're going to have here today. Chinese 4 curriculum, and Mike will get into a little bit of this, Chinese 4, along with some of our other foreign language programs like Italian, are programs that we want to continue to build a progression towards. We run Chinese 1, Chinese 2, and we just started this last year Chinese 3. Our numbers aren't quite where we want them to be, but it was something that we felt like we wanted to run and continue to build that program. Chinese 4, we're going to continue to monitor the enrollment, but we wanted to have the curriculum done and planned in advance of the students coming forward. We also try to make sure that every student in our district has access to those programs, and that requires us at the staffing time to look at some creative options. So sometimes we ask students to travel to a host school. We know that that's not ideal, but that's an option for some. We also work on exhausting all possibilities of doing distance learning, or where you're learning, you know, remotely from a computer, whether it's through a system that's set up in the classroom or whether it's a Google Hangout, and yet that's not always ideal either, and it also becomes a bit expensive. So we look at each of those scenarios, and ultimately our goal is to make sure that our students have access to those programs, and that's a process that the Teaching and Learning Department, I as a supervisor for the secondary schools, and the principals also work on as well. So I'll turn it over to Mike, and Mike can get into a little bit of the details of the Chinese 4.
Thanks, Mr. Smith. Good evening, everybody. Hope you're doing well. I would like to begin by introducing you to Julie Rabideau and Lisa Johnson. Many of you know Lisa. She's been with us for a number of years as a curriculum coordinator, and Julie is new to us this year, so welcome to her. She had been with us from Elda Leopold previously, where she taught science and other courses. As Mr. Smith identified, we are trying to be a bit proactive on this one by preparing and bringing forward curriculum frameworks for documents for Chinese 4. And as spelled out in the board report, this work we bring forward is really intended to kind of be ahead of the game and have us poised and positioned so that as students are interested and able to sign up for and take a fourth level of Chinese, that our scope and sequence is logical, and we did that work last year, and this year it continues. We also, as asked by the board last year, we've looked a little bit into the use of what we're calling our courses. Should they be called Cantonese or Mandarin? What's the appropriate terminology for that? We've done some legwork and looked at what's out there, what the standard is, and it really varies quite a bit. The majority seem to trend towards using Chinese in the course title, and so unless directed otherwise, we'll stick with that. Without speaking too much further, I'd offer that Julie can share with you a little bit of extra explanation. We'd be happy to answer questions.
We are asking for approval because the board approved Chinese 3 last year, and it's implemented this year. And the Chinese 4 curriculum was also written with the Chinese 3. And so we'd like to extend the program for the 2015-16 school year. The budget request includes money for resources and professional learning for the two teachers to work together in developing from course 3 to course 4.
And to really expand on the essentials of the course, and knowing that it is a small but a program we'd like to nurture a little further, to kind of provide an opportunity to spell out further what that course 4 would really look like. Again, trying to be proactive about it. That's really the long and short of it.
Other questions or comments?
Yes, I have a couple.
Chris.
The first one is, you know, I understand the different types of Chinese that may be taught. And so what type of Chinese is this?
It's Mandarin.
Okay. I don't know whether that's spelled out in different places. I would suggest it is when people look at it. If they're looking for Mandarin as they move, come. just a thought. The second one, I don't know whether it's an oversight, but in the write-up, unless I'm missing this, I only see percentages of increase in students. I don't see numbers there. So I don't know what that means. You know, if you have four students and you get one more, that's a 24% increase. Mm-hmm. So I you know, mm-hmm. you might
be more specific.
I don't ask you for the numbers right now, but I
sure.
guess I would like to see them.
Okay. I'm curious, do we want to dialogue a little bit around, should we revisit the conversation around the title of the course, or is it sufficient to have it in the course description as available in our publicly displayed course book? How, because I do recognize the need to be specific so people know what they'll be learning about.
Brenda.
You said, I mean, it's my experience looking at, you know, even college courses and things that usually it's called Chinese with the description of,
yeah.
you know, what it is. And Mandarin is the, probably the most common Chinese language that's taught. Is that
that's
right?
what's spoken most in China.
In China? Okay. So I personally would be comfortable with it in the description, because I think if you're talking about people that are coming here from outside of our district, and I think if they're interested in Chinese, they go to the course book, and if they can immediately find that it's Mandarin and not something else, then that answers their question.
Okay. Good.
But that's my personal.
I would
do
agree
other
with
board
that.
Members.
It needs to be stated in the narrative.
But do people feel the need to have it in the course title?
No.
Okay.
That fits well with the work that we're doing around the course description book, so that's timely and relative. So, good.
Okay.
I think it's really great that you're expanding to Chinese 4. When I was a freshman, I was looking at foreign language classes, and I only saw Chinese 1 and 2. And I mean, one of my main concerns was how to expand into the courses, since most secondary schools require you to or recommend you to at least have 2 or 3 years of foreign language. And I think it's really nice how you're expanding into it. Different language and the classic languages like Spanish, Italian, German, and French.
Mary. Tell us a little bit about the staffing situation as we continue to grow the program.
Yeah.
And are the teachers native speakers?
They are. Both of them are. And we've had to be persistent in finding educators. And we've also had to work with educators to ensure that their certification continues. We were fortunate to be able to have a teacher that is diversified in her certification, who's also math and is a native speaker, who is currently under emergency license and will continue to pursue regular licensure in that area of Chinese. So yeah, we feel really lucky to be in the position that we're in right now. We're looking at how do you grow the program both from an enrichment standpoint at some of our younger levels, and then also then ensure that there's you know, movement through Chinese 1, 2, 3, and 4. I think that that's one thing that in retrospect we wish that we would have had the course offerings established up front, so kids could see a pathway, so that they could see themselves going from Chinese 1 through 3, and we wonder what impact that might have had on our current enrollment. So that's a little bit of that balancing of act to how do we continue to support or nurture it and allow kids to move forward. Right now, Chinese 1 and 2 is being hosted over at Preble High School, and our numbers are 25 and about 20 right now. So if we can continue to move that same cohort of kids through, you know, we're excited to be able to get to 3 and 4 eventually.
And will that also be at Preble?
What we typically do in a course like this is we look at where's the highest percentage of enrollment. So Preble has the most students enrolled, so that typically is where it's hosted.
Maybe enrollment is such that because it's hosted there.
Correct. And that's one of the things that we looked at for East High School example, and we've been talking about that. What happens if you just set up a rotation? Ideally, it'd be great if you could host them at you know different or two sites potentially. through the staffing process, though, we talk about that. That's where the principal's voice really comes into play. You know, how many kids do your kids, do you think your kids are going to be able to travel? You know, if they don't travel, then we look at what are other options to allow them access to it as well. So we'll have that same conversation.
As we expand, we have staffing needs are met.
Yeah. 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 Pretty excited right now.
Andrew.
You can feel free to expand, but I would imagine the situation with Chinese isn't unique, but I've, going back quite a long time, I've been, you know, a real fan of we can use our size to offer a program in one place, and then the practical aspects are that students choose not to switch. Mm-hmm. It would be difficult to know how many just consciously or even subconsciously did just checked a different box because they knew or even heard, but it would say in the book where it's offered. Well, we won't really know how many students said no because of that once it's in the book. Do we know how many, do we get a feel for how many students are maybe planning a course before we decided where? And how, you know, do half of them say yes, I'll take it, or do almost all of them drop when they find out it's at another school?
Typically, from what I hear from the principals, is that that information is put out in the course description book, so we know ahead of time if kids are going to travel or not travel. The bigger, more organizational piece that we looked at is the kids that are currently in Chinese 2 would have been in Chinese 2 last year, would have gone to Chinese 3 this year. Many of them, because we didn't have 3 and 4 laid out initially, many of them got out right away and they went into a different one because they knew that they needed to get X amount of, you know, foreign language classes is for college. So we think that that impacted the progression more so than the traveling piece. So we wanted to try to get the whole scope and sequence of Chinese 1, 2, 3, and 4 out there so that folks saw that opportunity. And then I think we can be able to get deeper with your question, Andrew, which is what's inhibiting them? And then what are some of those things that we can do to help that process? I think we've come a long way with technology as well. Our teachers are starting to think about ways where they can leverage technology and have a kid take the class but be in a study hall or in a distance learning lab. That's come a long ways in the last 2 years too.
Are we doing that? I mean, are there people who have an arrangement? Are there a lot of people who have an arrangement during the study hall, or is this just a handful right now in the district, or do we have dozens of kids maybe doing this?
Well, distance learning is different than online, and we can get you the numbers on that, but I know there's one student from Southwest that is taking Chinese at Preble, and I believe that she's taking it through a technology-enhanced opportunity, but I can double-check that for you. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Brenda? Yes, my question.
No, okay. Put your hand
down. We have some of the same issues with, like, our AP calculus, too. We've had to be creative with that because you only have, you know, the BC section is run at Southwest, and you have Preble kids that want to do that as well. So we've had to think creatively about that as well, and that's where you get into some distance learning as well.
I guess I would just say I know for the thinking creatively about how to do it piece, I remember, you know, starting years ago,
mm-hmm.
which is good. But if there's one kid, you know, there's more than one kid from a different school who wants to take Chinese, but there's one doing a distance learning. You know, I'm sure there's, so, you know, is that, I think until we get to the point where it's, where we're able to say in the handbook, offered at Preble, distance learning options available,
mm-hmm.
a lot of the time that a course is only offered in one spot. Until we're doing that a lot,
yeah.
It's students don't really have the choice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, transportation can improve it, not as much as distance learning would, because transportation's even if we lay it out, it's still a problem. It's a miss period. So
yeah.
So I'm glad to see we're moving, but I would have, you know, we've been thinking about it for a while, and I would have rather heard that there's 7 people doing.
Sure.
Chinese that way than one.
Let me get back to the board on how many kids that are taking distance learning online. I can give you the numbers on that. I think that that's, that'll help you understand it. Yep.
I was quite following the bouncing ball. Is it now available for kids in Chinese and you mentioned Italian to take it long distance from the whole school or not? Or it had to go to an outside agency to sign up?
No.
So I think in
two different.
Yeah. I think this is a generalization, but in general, if a course isn't facility dependent, we post it in the course book as available at all four schools, and then based on student interest is where the staffing decision can influence. Well, let's run it out of here, and then we communicate out to the students, you know, hey, this year it's going to be hosted here, and then we work on how might we respond to those requests. So that's a generalization, but in general, that's how we've tried to become a little more flexible and adaptive. So from a year-to-year basis, there might be a greater push for it here or there. And from the front end, and from the staffing end, I think you respond to it maybe after
so
that.
So if I understood what you just said, right now, in terms of long-distance learning, you know, among our schools, that's not an option that's laid out there for these types of classes. Is that correct? And I think part to perhaps Andrew's point, you said it and I didn't pick up on it well. If that option, if I'm at Southwest or West, and I know the class is only offered at Prep, one that historically has, I may be disinclined to sign up for it. If I know I have the option to either go there or long distance learning, for lack of a better term, I might sign up for it. But then, you know, the first case scenario, I wouldn't sign up for it. The second case, maybe there are 10 kids out there that sign up for it. Then all of a sudden you know you have much more demand than you would have known otherwise.
Yep.
Something to think about.
Yep.
Any other questions, comments, concerns? Hearing none, we'll move that forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next item is the Family Consumer Science Equivalency Courses.
And what I'd like to do is introduce that kind of in conjunction with the also the Agri Science Equivalency courses, because in general they were brought forward to the board for, we had requested approval to submit to the state applications. Those applications were approved by the state, and so we've continued the process to spell out the curriculum documents a little bit further. And both Lisa and Julie are here to talk a little bit more about the specifics of the equivalency courses that are offered. As a point of context and history, you may recall that as a result of the third science credit being required in the state of Wisconsin moving forward, our current sophomores will be required to have 3 credits of science in order to get high school graduation. We did change our board policy relative to that, and now we looked at what additional courses might make sense, if any, and we put forward these equivalency requests. A science equivalency course can be offered through the areas of family consumer science, agri-science, also there's a Project Lead the Way course, as we talked about earlier at a previous board meeting, that is also an equivalency course currently offered in our technical and engineering education areas. The folks have worked with the staff members to take the approved applications and spell out the course documents a bit further. They've continued their work with the teachers around getting prepared to offer that in our schools for next year so that students have additional options. And I'll let Julie and Lisa talk a little bit about each of those. We'll start first with our family consumer science courses.
So as Mike explained a little bit about the history, he and I actually met with our family consumer science, ag science, and science teachers, and we really talked about through that process, and we worked with them to kind of put out the what the course would look, the different courses would look like, to get the paperwork submitted to DPI. And through that process, it was is extremely important for us to have those science folks at the table as well, and really to learn from each other as we continue down the path of a science equivalency in those areas. And as we did that, we kind of did the basic scope of the courses through the DPI process. And then this school year, we've been continuing to work with them, and Julia explained a little bit about what we've been doing with them.
Each of the Family Consumer Science and Ag Science are going to be offering 2 half-credit science courses. So they're two semester courses. For the family consumer science, we're offering a food science process and production. And the science, we're going to beef it up, and there's going to be science more behind the food processing. And I've been working a lot with the teachers on understanding the food and the science part of the food processing and production, and then how ingredients combine, not just what tastes good together, but the science behind why ingredients mix together well. The other one is the nutritional science. We do currently have that course, but we restructured it so that it includes more of the science behind the nutrition and the wellness piece. So those are the two for family consumer science. And the budget request that we're asking includes the resources, which includes a lot of the equipment that are not available to the teachers in those areas, as well as the professional learning around the science part of the course, so those teachers can continually be supported with that science piece.
Essentially, the labs in these courses will look a little different than the lab-based work that they've done for assessing purposes and such previously, because of the expectation of the science standards being taught through the courses as well.
Questions? Chris.
Thank you. If I'm tracking this right, you develop the curriculum in each area here, and then the state approves it. Is that correct?
Yes, and it's a little bit quirky because the state has a certain number of forms and documents you fill out that is different than our typical curriculum development process. So it was kind of like we followed the state expectation to get approved, and now since it was approved, we can continue to ensure that our process is followed and spelled out a little bit further.
When we think of science, we think of quite a bit of academic rigor. Mm-hmm. Are you, I guess I'm broadly asking this question, are you all comfortable that there is that sort of rigor with the science now added to, not that there wasn't rigor in a different way, please understand that, but are you comfortable with that too?
I would offer that at the big picture level, that DPI has already kind of recognized through their approval process that the crosswalks where you take the science standards, the family consumer or the agri-science standards that you crosswalk to show how you're going to show the science and how they compare and combine. We also took the extra step of looking at the newly adopted family consumer and newly adopted agri-science and the newly the next generation science standards to ensure that we had that future rigor, because frankly the Department of Public Instruction did not update their materials for approval. We chose to update them on our end to be forward thinking, which we felt raised the rigor to a level that was beyond what was even expected. So to that extent, I think we're quite comfortable. I think as Julie and Lisa articulated around supporting teachers and getting ready to teach the course, we want to continue to support them and give them opportunities to understand what the science-y aspect of it is so that it is a high quality experience. So I don't know if that exactly answered your question, but that's how we've tried to address that to this point.
I personally am happy to see this being done. I think few people realize how much science is behind the scene in both those areas. And I think that makes those areas that much more interesting, actually.
Yeah. I think if I could offer, I think it's also a good indication of the forward thinking that Mike and his team are taking advantage of the opportunities. You know, DPI provides us the guidance, and yet we have to be able to think through things and to be out in front of it as well. And the teachers really the opportunity to raise up to that challenge as well. I think that there could possibly be, you know, some teachers that say, no, we're okay what we're doing. These folks said, bring it on. You know, we want to accept that challenge. And I think that that's also another good indication of our district as well.
Andrew.
Yes, there's a reference in here to professional learning time between teachers of both departments, which philosophically is a good thing, but I'm wondering, is this going to create a situation where teachers whose planning time has already become less their own choice than it once was will be even less, or will the proportion of self-directed versus district-directed time remain the same even for people in these areas?
I think I'll take a swing at what I think that you're, please clarify if you think I have this wrong. The intentionality behind writing in some of that additional cross-collaboration with these unique courses gets back to what Dr. Wagner asked about, is ensuring that the rigor of the course matches the rigor of expectation science. Because these are cross departments, we wanted to try to create opportunities for people to engage in either observing other classes. We've already done, Julie, you did take the family consumer science folks out to another school district to do some observations of an already approved course being taught this way. So it's not intended to be an extra burden taking them away, but rather an opportunity for them to engage and see models and collaborate to understand about that rigorous level that's expected.
And I guess I'm not really talking about exchanges. I'm talking specifically about, is this going to, I mean, a high school teacher has how much planning time left that's theirs to use? I don't remember exactly, but it's not what it was 10 years ago. I mean, we district direct a chunk of that planning time?
Well, I think it varies, Andrew, but the intent is that they have both individual and collaborative opportunity. In collaborative, I would offer that as a former principal, these elective area teachers oftentimes don't have somebody to collaborate with because of the number of preps that they might teach or the lack of connectivity. Here's an opportunity for them to really connect with a team to be able to work together as a team as part of their regular job embedded professional learning. We don't see this as another thing. It's going to be work as usual for a teacher that would have this particular prep. That certainly is not our intent to have that become more work for them. Initial learning is going to be important, just like it would be for any teacher that picks up a new course, but we don't see this as an add-on.
Yeah, and the intent of the professional learning in the budget amount is really for summer work, so those teachers can get together during the summer to collaborate before the school year starts as they continue planning for the course.
But does the handbook contain a certain number of minutes that a high school teacher has of individual planning?
Yep.
Okay.
I don't have it memorized, but I can on average.
Will people doing this arrangement still have that amount?
Yeah, absolutely. They'll be no different than any other teacher that teaches their workload, whatever their assignment is.
It's unique. I mean, I get that there's a need for this cross department planning time, and if it's, you know, having a sub day to swap classrooms or go to another district, that's not, planning time's a limited resource, so I just wanted to clarify.
Sure. Yep.
I don't want someone to be taking this feeling, you know, deciding whether or not to take this, wondering whether it means more, you know, we've talked a lot about meetings.
Sure.
And so, okay, thank you.
Yep.
Quick question. Do you anticipate developing community partnerships with a lot of the food processing businesses in our area?
I think it's a great idea.
We sure should.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We have some of that started, yeah.
Good.
Yeah, with Lori.
Yeah.
We've got a couple things.
I was in a food testing laboratory last Friday, so I know they exist right across the street. It's wonderful.
Anything else? All right. We'll move forward to the next.
Thank you.
So that covered both ag science and?
Well,
or we're doing ag science now?
No.
I'm sorry.
Ag science.
Let's do
ag science.
Yep.
Hold on. Ag science, it's due.
Yep.
And it's the same as far as the science equivalency, but these two courses for ag science would be advanced veterinary and animal science, which would be looking at the biology of the animals and getting into the veterinary science for those kids. And then the advanced plant science and design is a more rigorous course looking at the botany of plants, as well as this floral design for people who want to get into floral design, and also landscaping. So, and again, the budget includes resources, which includes lab materials, and then teacher time to share ideas.
Brenda.
The previous description of the courses included writing lab reports, doing labs, things like that. This description did not. Is there still going to be a lab emphasis in these two courses, and they will be writing lab reports and those kinds of things?
Yes. Okay. We're working on that with the teachers.
Okay.
So why did you take it out?
These are both brand new courses, so that these are not replacing current courses that we have, so they're brand new. So within these, that was a kind of an oversight to see have that in there, not have that in there.
That's something we can add.
So they're currently working on it.
Didn't appear in there. Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that it was part of the conversation.
Yep. Right. Thank you.
Anything else? Hearing done, we'll move that forward.
Thank you.
English language arts content/course essential documents. We'll have the changing guard.
We'd like to welcome to the table colleagues Nancy Sharp here, as well as two of our curriculum coordinators. Nancy will formally introduce them in just a smidge. What we bring forward tonight again reflects the kind of the culminating work regarding our transition to a guaranteed and viable Common Core state standards based curriculum for English language arts pre-K through 12. Work has been done on this curriculum to vertically align pre-K 12. At the onset, I would be remiss if I didn't thank both our current and former curriculum coordinators who've helped our district with this multi-year transition through the Common Core. A special note of appreciation, of course, for the staff members that have served on these curriculum committees to ensure that we've gotten to this point tonight. So I'd like to thank them for that.
And the content essential documents and course outlines were developed to assist all stakeholders, educators, parents, and administrators in gaining a deeper understanding of the Common Core state standards and identify their essential learnings. They contain the pre-K-12 guaranteed and viable curriculum of the district and will be referenced by and when developing pre-K-5 integrated units of study, and also our daily lesson plan. Tonight we have Angela Combe and Beth Taylor, our very talented elementary and secondary curriculum coordinators, to talk with the board around the English language arts curriculum and the process that they followed. And we're happy at the conclusion of their presentation to answer any further questions you might have. Angie?
I will speak for the elementary portion. The process that we took involved having teams of teachers, approximately six teachers per grade level, come to the district office and work together to create the content essential documents. Teachers from those groups included representation from the bilingual classrooms as well as from the special education department. In that process, we unpacked the standards by asking the question, what does the standard mean, and thinking about what students need to be able to do or know in order to show evidence that they have met the standard. We worked with 4K as all the way through grade 5, and that ensured that we had a progression of skills as we moved sequentially through each grade level. References for our work included Teaching Strategies Gold for PK, the Wisconsin Early Learning Standards, and then for grades K through 5, we used Frances and Pinnell's Literacy Continuum to help support our work. The content essential documents were created under the framework of the standards. So as we move into the course overview, you'll see that in the section that is called Topics at a Glance, that is in that section, you'll see the major strands for the standards for each grade level. The course description offers a parent-friendly version of what students will need to know and be able to do in that content area, focusing on the critical areas. Assessments include both formative and summative assessments that can be used for each of the content areas. And then the portrait of a literate student describes the characteristics that we would want to see in a literate student who is interacting with the world around them. Grade level expectations, teams of teachers reflected on the standard as well as the evidence outcomes on the content essential document when creating the grade level expectation, which is essentially a summary of what the student would be able to know or be able to do in that area. And then the instructional strategies listed are the strategies that are contained within our literacy framework. And I really found that the teachers in this process left each time with a deeper understanding, and I work with the literacy content leads within the district, and they've spoken very positively at all of our meetings since last year about the process and the learning that occurred during that process. And they not only speak at our meetings, but also speak to their colleagues at the building about the process that they went through and how they have gained more understanding of the Common Core State Standards through the process.
Good evening. I'll be addressing the secondary language arts, English language arts aspect of the course essential documents. So the purpose of the secondary English language arts course essential documents is to define what students need to know and be able to do in language arts courses and to support teacher instructional planning to meet standards expectations. Content area, ELL, and special ed teachers met in collaborative teams to develop the course essential documents. The course essential documents are framed through the Common Core content areas and grouped by content-specific strands. Through a process of unpacking English Language Arts Common Core grade level standards, teams defined the expectations and identified evidence outcomes for each grade level standard. Course level overviews for each grade were developed that highlight key areas of the course. Course descriptions are a narrative overview of the course. Topics at a glance are an outline of the concepts and the content. Assessments identify the standards-based assessments for the course. Standards of the course overview the strands for each content standard and include a portrait of a literate student, which defines the actions learners take when interacting with a literate environment. Grade level expectations highlight the key essential learning for each strand. And instructional strategies list the tools teachers could use to teach the content. Teams of teachers work diligently and cooperatively to develop the course essential documents. And through their work, the teachers developed a deeper understanding of the Common Core standards at the grade level. The teachers have expressed how the process was beneficial to their professional learning and how the documents will be supportive to their colleagues.
At this time, we'll field any questions you might have around the English language arts curriculum development.
And when I read through this before, earlier today and last night, the question I had for myself is, because I know there are content literacy standards also. So then I didn't necessarily see them in here, but what you're telling me is that they're in here? I mean, because you worked with content teachers with the secondary group. So I guess my question is, does a science teacher pick up grade 6 language arts curriculum and look through that, or how are we helping that content literacy teacher to teach the English language arts curriculum in a way that's going to help our students?
No, so essentially this was working through the English language arts curriculum and courses, and now as we tackle the social studies and science as our final two core areas, we'll be integrating what are referred to kind of as those disciplinary literacy standards that go across all contents and looking at how those are going to be reflected in the work that we do with those content areas.
Okay, so when you said content, you meant English language arts content teachers.
Correct.
Got it. Okay.
Correct.
I was thinking you were cross-disciplinary already. Okay, so that's how you're going to work those into the science and social studies standards as the language arts standards of that content.
Yes.
And we are also in the elementary five crosswalking the ELA standards with our science and social studies curriculum.
Oh, okay.
And the writing of the science and social studies curriculum. Angie, did you want to elaborate on the social studies piece of that? Just a little insight, please.
I've been working with the social studies groups currently, and it has been very efficient for teachers to be able to think about and a lot of them are already familiar with the documents, so they have been able to make some links and incorporate those in the evidence outcomes for social studies now.
Okay, good.
Which would make because the elementary teachers are teaching English language arts, social studies, and, so
that is correct.
They're going to have that.
that is one piece of the teachers that I've worked with are very excited about. In fact, I worked with a group today, and at the end of the day, they just said, we are so excited to be able to really focus on the day. And they said in the past, students have said, oh, we've talked about this in social studies, or oh. And now we're going to be able to just have that be a natural part of their day, where students don't have to recognize that we may have talked about it earlier in the day. They will have talked about it throughout the day because the teachers are able to integrate things more easily now.
Good.
I guess I wanted to make a comment that I think is probably obvious to everyone in this room, but probably not to people in our community, that the Common Core State Standards in English Language Arts are not federally mandated curriculum. These are standards that our staff took and developed Green Bay-based curriculum around the state standards. And I know we all in this room realize that, but there's this persistent misconception that the federal government has mandated curriculum and that the curriculum in Green Bay is not Green Bay curriculum, but this is Green Bay based and developed curriculum based on the state's the Common Core. So I just thought that needed to be said again, not for anybody in this room, but for those in our community and some people in Madison who believe that somehow we're giving up control over our curriculum, and we're not.
Thank you. Chris.
Piggybacking on that, I have a little concern with the terminology here that I think, to me it's misleading. Common Core / based curriculum, and to me that implies that it is just the opposite of what Mr. Blecka just said, so I'd appreciate it if you look at that language in here. I'm looking at the background.
Where are you referring, Chris?
Well, the first document.
The cover page?
Background, second paragraph.
Yep.
As culminating work on the district transition to a Common Core based curriculum. I think that's misleading based on what everything that we know has been said.
Well, we certainly can offer a comment, but that is certainly not our intent. We've always seen Common Core as the floor by which we write our curriculum, written by the Green Bay school district teachers, aligned to the Common Core, but it is certainly not the Common Core. Very good point.
Our documents are aligned. They are curriculum based, but there's much more to our content essential documents than just the standards. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what we're alluding to here, is that it is a base from which we began our writing, but with them we added our Green Bay curriculum to it.
I fully appreciate what you're saying, and I know what's been done here.
Yep.
These types of documents go out to the public.
Yep.
Absolutely.
There are a lot of people in the public that don't care for Common Core standards.
Yep.
And we've said one thing, but that terminology in there makes something different. It muddies the water.
Yep.
We can correct
Fair
that.
Enough.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Anything else? I just want to make sure that the language then would be curriculum based aligned to.
Yeah. Okay. Or curriculum aligned transit or Common Core aligned or
It's aligned to the Common Core.
Correct.
That doesn't
correct.
Mean it is the curriculum.
Correct.
And that's really what.
Right. Yep.
Yeah.
Fix that. Right. Absolutely.
Thank you for pointing that out. Okay. Oh, very good.
Thank
Not
you.
Excellent, though.
It was excellent.
Did you want
excellent?
It was a good catch.
It was a very
Thank you guys.
Good catch.
Thank
I knew what they meant, so I didn't want to hold her in my
right.
head, but yes.
All right.
We have our next discussion item will be the district calendar for 2015-16.
We're waiting for Mr. Harswick to join us.
Running out of people coming to the
Of the crowd in the back.
Come on down, Dave.
Just like church.
No. Well, here we are again in January, ready to present to you the calendar for the next school year.
We usually try to come around this time of the year. This year's calendar is very similar, I would say, in structure as to the calendar that we are currently functioning under this year. We worked collaboratively again with the GBEA, Dave and Lori and Brad Greister, along with our administrative team, to continue to look at the calendar. How are things going this year? What was the information that we gathered from our staff last year when we did the survey? We continue to look at that, pull that out, see if there's something we might still be missing. And this year, I think, if I were to say anything, it's pretty close to what we're doing this year. If you look, a couple of the highlights I would indicate are that we've tried to stay, we have to start still after start in September, so we've got that September 1st start date. And we're trying to get out of school despite weather in that second week of June, no later than that. That helps us kind of spread our calendar out. We've tried to look at, what are some places that there might be natural breaks that we can attach compensation days for spring break or winter recess so that things are lined up together and they're not sporadic. I think if we were to look at our professional learning days, as you recall last year, we stopped doing the late starts and moved towards the early releases. This year we looked around and played around with trying to get away from maybe even going from early release to some full day professional learning opportunities. And what we learned is we have a little more work to do on that because what we would have gained by full day professional learning, we would have lost a lot of time because it sounds like it makes sense. Well, you have a half day of professional learning, so two half days make a whole. But that's not how it works with the calendar and when you start counting instructional minutes. So I think we kind of figured it out. For us to gain even 2 days of professional learning full days, we lost a huge amount of time to be able to be with staff. So I think that's our goal. We'd like to eventually, look at those early releases, make sure. I think they align nicely right now with what Mark's trying to do with our professional learning communities, and it gives us another year to kind of work through that process, learn more about how those function, and then maybe we can make a shift. Other than that, do you have something you want to add?
I'm never short for words, so I apologize. we did look at it quite deliberately, down to the minutes and trying to find out where do you get the most opportunity for your staff members to really get involved with professional development and have it become meaningful. And yet it just didn't work out. We wouldn't have as many opportunities for our staff to come together. And we didn't want to compromise that, especially as we continue to work to create a culture in our buildings where we're supporting teachers to be able to work together or to be able to work on their curriculum and it not be another thing. We also have an opportunity as we continue to examine our scheduling options. As that work continues, the calendar work will also come along with that. So we just wanted to make sure that we had as much flexibility moving forward, I think, and that was essentially the end result.
The other couple things that I would highlight, and then Dave, if you have anything to add or Jean, I think looking at our weather days, trying to make sure, as you recall, we used to have one day, and if we went beyond one day, we had to make it up, then we built in a second day. Last year, we went with the alternative third day, that if we didn't need it, students and staff would not need to report to school. And if we did need it, then they would have to come to school. That is in the calendar again this year. So we have 3 days. And then what we've also tried to do is when we put the calendar out, add those 2 days in June, just in case, so that people aren't making plans and thinking, well, we're out on Wednesday, I can go Thursday, Friday.
Right.
We intentionally try to list 2 additional weather makeup days on that Thursday and Friday, so people know those would be where we put them, and then if we don't use them, then we're done early. So that's the other piece, and then spring break. As you know, it's been a tradition for us to have a spring break each year. So last year we scheduled spring break, then we learned from ACT that they were going to be testing during our spring break window. And this year I think we've been able to avoid that. So we've got our spring break built in. So anything from?
I don't have anything. I think Kim Mark said it very well.
Yeah.
it's worked well for all of us to hunker down in Jean's conference room and hammer it out. So far, I think that's a good lot. I would say a lot of good conversation. Mm-hmm. A lot of thought goes into the calendar on both sides. Yeah.
And staff appreciate having it as soon as they can. So, you know, next week, should the board vote to approve it, we get it out right away. So many people make their plans early around this calendar, and I think other districts, schools look at our calendar as guidance.
I know Mark will have a couple talking points around professional learning in summer that we'll want to put together when we get things out to staff so that they understand the professional learning, that what it looks like from a summer perspective. So before we send it out, we'll put some talking points together and then get it out to staff.
Any questions or comments? Chris?
In the past, we had a lot of concern raised by parents about the late starts. And I don't know about other board members, but I was approached several times on that. I haven't heard a thing about early release. Does that follow through in what you've heard from the buildings or direct contact?
I think initially when we put the calendar out, I received maybe one or two at the most phone calls, had offered some explanation. Since then, I haven't received anything. I don't know about the rest of the group.
You're talking to the person responsible for continuous improvement, so I'm always looking at ways to improve. But that's really what we'd like to do, is from an early release standpoint, is really make sure that we're maximizing the opportunity for the teachers. And we have growth in that area, and we'll continue to work on that and make sure that it's value add for them and it impacts the students. So I think that's about the only concern, and that's something we'll continue to look at and evaluate and move forward on. We can always improve in that area.
And I think the other piece is we're trying to look at some organizational data around student attendance on half days. Mm-hmm. That's why we had one of the conversations around going to full day versus half. Is there a change in attendance? And I think we need to get a couple years worth of data to really dig in, but we are using those pieces and trying to take those things into consideration.
Questions or comments?
Appreciate your thoughtful process. Mm-hmm.
We'll move that forward.
Okay.
Next item, space availability for open enrollment.
Well, that's me too. So, Melissa and I. As you know, the open enrollment requirements, and open enrollment, just a reminder for everyone, is students that wish to come to our district from another district. Not in district where students want to go from one school to another. So we're only talking about open enrollment on these. In January, the board needs to determine the number of regular education and special education spaces that we have available as a district at each grade level. So in your report, you will see the recommendation that the administration is making of what those numbers are for each grade level. In addition, we also set spaces as a district. Not every district does this, but because we believe we have many opportunities for our students in certain specialized programming, such as Da Vinci or JDAL or GT or IB, we set our spaces for those programs as well as for the grade levels, so that we keep those two separated, which allows us the opportunity to kind of look more individually at the opportunities that a student may be looking for. So you as the board in January need to approve those spaces that we set. They worked hard to establish those. Some are up from last year, some are down from last year. We used the same formula, and we're using the same process this year to go through with, if you recall, the preference window of internal first. So we have a window of application where if I go to school in the district, I can ask to go to another school. Once that window's done, then we look at open enrollment window. So these are really just that second phase.
And if
why
I can just
is
offer-
Preble listed as a closed school?
Well,
why is Preble listed?
Why isn't it listed as a closed school?
We haven't closed any of our high school or middle school.
Certainly no room at
all. And if I can just clarify too, when a student asks to open enroll into a district, they ask to,
they ask to open enroll into the district, not a particular school. Mm-hmm. And so once we approve a student to open enroll into the district, we then get to determine what school or program they go to. So when we sit down in this room and hammer this out, we will look at the numbers at Preble, and most times they are too tight to allow a student to open enroll into Preble, and so we'll offer an alternative placement for that student. Yep. And in addition to that, you'll notice that on some of our programs and in some of our grades, we're very tight, and so the numbers will list zero. We, in the process of sitting in that room on that day, we will establish a wait list. And even if the number is zero, or we have one spot and we have 10 applicants, we'll allow that one student in, or we will wait list everybody where the numbers are zero. And then once the date passes in June for our determination and spots open up thereafter, even though we've set it zero, we can take students off of that list because we've established a wait list, and we can put them into their desirable spots here in the district. So it may look like we're very tight, but as you know, students continue to move in and out mm-hmm. all during the summer, and we continue to monitor that all during the summer in order to try and accommodate as many as we can.
And just for clarification, what Mike is talking about is we set the spaces by grade,
yeah.
not by school. Mm-hmm. But in the report, we listed for you those schools that we identify as closed right now, because we have certain processes and procedures in place for our closed schools. And at this time, these are the ones, and you know, Mark can probably speak to the secondary most, but I think it's always hard to close a secondary school because there may be a student who wants to come in that fits just right into a schedule that we have classroom space available to give them that those classes that they're looking for. It's a little different than at the elementary where I have a homeroom or a class and there's so many in that class and they stay in that mm-hmm. class pretty much all day.
With that said, Edison, Red Smith, and Preble are extremely closely monitored, and it's extremely difficult to get into those schools.
And Smith is on our list.
Yeah.
Yep.
Thank you.
Brenda.
I'm looking just at the project-based learning group or section or whatever that is, and the capacity is listed at 60, but the building I've been told can hold, I don't know, 80?
Yeah.
And so what is... So does this mean, anyway, explain that to me. Does this, I'm hoping that this doesn't limit our ability to get to 80 with open enrollment if that's the last, you know, five students or whatever that come in as from outside of our district, even though it says zero.
Correct. The formula is gauged around what you have staffing available for, and the contract puts forth a 20 student per advisor ratio. So they have three advisors, so we've based it upon that. Now we would look at increasing staffing if needed to continue to do that. So we wanted to start with what do we have from a process standpoint. And that's about the best guide that we have, and we certainly would review that. And the other challenge at the secondary level is we're asked to put forth these space availabilities prior to the staffing that we process right. that we would go through.
Yeah.
So we could adjust that by adding staff and then working through it that way as
okay.
well. And that's
so
our
these
intent.
These protect us from having to accept people that we then have to hire a staff specifically for.
Correct.
That doesn't prevent us from hiring staff and having open enrollment kids
right.
come in at any
Correct.
Anywhere in the district.
The DPI always recommends set spaces low because, again, you can always wait list and then
right.
take the kids off the wait list.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of the reason why we went to establishing program
right.
versus grade level
yeah.
only.
And that does not prevent then John Dewey from going out and recruiting and advertising and all of that. And we've spoken to them about that as well.
Right.
Yeah.
So if they have 20 kids that want to come,
yeah.
we hire staff and
yep.
some will come from open. Yeah.
Yep.
This capacity is not building capacity, it's capacity based
it's
on
current staff.
Current
staff.
Staffing.
Correct.
Thanks.
Andrew. There are certain programs in here, such as John Dewey, that are obviously programs school building specific. My concern is when we list the availability of a program slot like fifth tier three gifted and talented as zero, as opposed to even staffing up to allow for one or two, does that have a, or do we have any way of knowing whether that has a chilling effect on whether or not people will even try? I mean, if I see five, I might believe I have a chance to get in. If I see 0000000, I might not waste my time. I mean, unless I've done a lot of research and know that the district hires off of waiting lists. Does that question make sense?
Yeah, the GT tiers is a difficult one. And you know, we believed if we were gonna set program spaces for one program, we should set them for all. So, you know, I guess the question, Andrew, is a valid one. I worry about if we put more spaces there than what we truly have available, because all means all, above or below. So Melissa will explain to you the detail of that, but ultimately means if we go over what we project in one category, we have to go over in all. So we've tried to really look at what is truly our space availability. And I'm not sure that anyone really looks at what we've set them at from a, I'm interested in coming to your school. And we've talked about GT, and I honestly right now I can't say that we have families who come to us for our district-wide GT programming. And what we do in our programming is if we have students who qualify for GT, we have to serve them. So we could set it at five or we could set it at zero. We still are going to program them if they qualify for GT. So I don't know if it would sway someone or not.
I think Kim could tell you how many people we have waited to be tested, which would probably demonstrate that people have not been discouraged to try and apply.
Correct.
And get into the program.
Correct. So what we did is took the formula, used it like we do with all of our other areas, and made sure we were true to the formula, and that's what we come up with. So based on our staffing, which could tend to tell you that we're understaffed in district-wide GT, if you looked at that.
So that you're saying that as far as both GT and other programs, although there may be cases you don't know, you don't seem too overly concerned that people will look and say, I'm not gonna bother even waitlisting. They'll call, they'll find out there's a waitlist, they'll go on the waitlist.
Well, I mean, they got to go through the process of applying and all of that.
Right.
But yeah, I have not heard, I don't think, any of the other individuals sitting at this table who are in charge of a program have had any anecdotal information about families not even trying to apply based on our numbers. And I think Claudia probably sees the most because she's probably has the tightest program. And every year we are waitlisting kids in her programs for open enrollment.
I guess we wanted to be true to the formula, so that we're consistent, and if we're audited, we're true to the formula. And I don't believe in, particularly in GT, that zero is going to stop anyone from coming to our district. I think I can say that. And the other piece I think is too, it's flexible staffing. It's a little more flexible than a classroom teacher. You know, we have ratios of student to our GTRTs, but it's a little flexible. If someone comes and we have to pick up one more student, we have more flexibility there than we do in a class size regarding SAGE limits or other things.
Any other?
Yeah, I have one more. This is in the memo, not the charts. And I've probably had the probably have the question almost every year I've been on the board. So just for, just to keep the history going here. So page 2 of the opening memo, which I still don't understand the answer very well. Okay. So secondary classrooms we calculate at 26 for 6th grade, 27th for 7th, 8th, 28th for 9th, for 12th to allow for projected enrollment growth. Okay, that sounds good. And then we said, in general, ratios don't exceed 30-1 or and 32-1. I would think most would consider that bad to hit 30 or 32. I would think generally or the district and community probably wouldn't like that, even though there's not very hard science research saying that 32 is horrible to high school level. I'd still, there's intangibles. As soon as you say in general, though, doesn't it not really mean a whole lot? I mean, is there, you know, I guess my question for a long time has been, is there, because I know there is, there has to be some number that's truly intolerable or we will split a class in half if we have to rent space, mm-hmm. right? I mean, I'm sure if you hit 40, it would be a mandatory, we have to split this in half. If we hit 38, I bet we would, no matter what, split that up. If we say in general 32 won't be exceeded, then I would assume you wouldn't break a new section at 32.
Yeah.
Would you at 33? Yeah. Maybe if it's not too much of a hardship, but at some point you're going to, even if it's very expensive and difficult, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it gets even more complex, if I could add. I think the term in the board policy also has on average. And then, you know, and then it includes total class load that a teacher would have. So as not to exceed, you know, 150 students over a day period or over, you know, week long period. So, but to your question, Andrew, there is both an art and a science to that, because it depends upon the type of class that we're looking at as well. You typically would see a 32 average in a PE class. You know, not that our PE teachers don't deserve small classes, but that's a little bit more manageable than a, you know, an algebra 9, you know, where kids are transitioning in and it's their first experience. So some of those pieces come into play as well. We like to keep our class averages below 30. That's we feel like we're aligned to board policy. It's aligned to, you know, best practices. Unfortunately, there are some classes that are at 30, you know, and so we continue to monitor that. Principals do a good job and teachers do a good job of letting us know when it becomes too difficult to manage.
Do we have any over 32 besides the possible couple of PE?
I could run some reports for you and let you know. I'd be guessing at this point.
I'd be interested knowing, though it's not an immediate priority.
Yeah, and we know that going into next year, one of the areas that we're going to continue to look at is lab classrooms, and the class averages in some of our lab settings. I think that we, as a district, have gone through a little bit of a transition around what do we typically staff lab classrooms at, as based upon how many lab stations there are, And so that's a work in progress for us as we continue to staff for next year as well. Yeah, because we want to make sure as we add more science classes that we have the experiences for kids to be able to get in and to do the science part of those classes as well.
And I guess what I would add, so this will be my second year to have enrollment as far as in-district transfers and out-of-district coming in. You know, I think we've added a really close lens lately to what are we doing to our class sizes when we have these requests. So middle of the year and I'm over at Preble or I'm at Edison and I want to go to a different school, we look at those things. We don't just say, well, you know what, you're in our district and we're going to let you go where you want to go because we want to do that. That's nice and we want to accommodate our parents, But what we also do is pull up our numbers, look at them, look to see, you know, what classes are they in, what classes are they going to go to, is that going to cause another class over here to go up above the limit that we, where we want to try to hold that. And we actually have probably a bigger waiting list right now than I think we've had in the years that I've been here, where we just had to say, I'm sorry, we don't have room for you. We don't have room for you to go from this school over to this school in the middle of the year, because here's where our staffing's at, and we already have 30 students in that room. So we've had to do those things too, because you're not going to add a teacher for one student. So you have to, we have to be able to look at those pieces as well, and we've been doing that. Every Monday, we look at the requests that come in as a group. We try to make sure we have the answer and that we're putting a lens of class size on that.
I think it's important to understand that open enrollment used to be this finite thing in time that school districts sat down and considered applications. It really has become this ongoing, yearly, almost full-time process where it takes a village to continually assess and review these requests. I know the Milwaukee School District has two or three full-time people that simply do open enrollment because it has become such an animal in a school district, particularly in our size, to review. Claudia is continues to get a number of requests. Barb is all involved quite often, and then on the elementary and secondary level. So this isn't something that we will sit in a room in April and hammer out. It goes on and on and on and on.
Well, we just had, I think, 8 to 10 in the last couple weeks that are either open enrollment asking to come in or our own students asking to go to a different school. So just in the last, since right before break till now, we had to address another 8 to 10 of them. So, and that's typical. It's kind of a typical 2-week period.
Anything else? Brenda?
Just so I'm understanding the process, when you do it in the middle of the year, is it easier because you know where your staff are as compared to in April when you're still, you know, you don't have staff in place? But it's still the, do you still then follow these numbers, or do you just take case by case basis and put them in? Because, I mean, I guess I'm wondering if, you know, 5 students leave a school that had, was at zero spaces, and you've got 2 that want to come into that school. Are we allowed to let them in the middle of the year because we know we have space?
We have to follow the numbers that the board sets in January until the board sets new numbers in January. So if we got a request right now prior to you setting numbers next week, we have to go back and look at how many, let's say it's for fifth grade. We have to go back and look at how many we've accepted into fifth grade. Make sure there's no sibling involved because that produces a whole new set of rules. Make sure it's compliant with the alternative application. And then if we have already accepted all of those kids, we can't exceed those spaces because then, as Kim noted, we'd have to accept everybody in on all the other lists and the wait list. So we would have to either wait list or deny.
Okay. So we have to monitor all year long. We have to check out all of that. We have to look at our wait list.
So even if we have space, we still are bound by these numbers.
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So that it's true to the system.
And
going to the preference window, I have to tell you, has been extremely helpful from a staffing perspective. So when we sit down in March with our first internal requests and do that preference window, that has really helped us, I think, be able to establish the staff. Once that staff is established, then all of the other things that come in after that, we at least kind of know where we're at and what we need to do. So that preference window, I think, has been extremely helpful from a staffing perspective.
Chris.
2 comments, if I may. It's supposed to be fun to be on a merry-go-round, but I guess this might be an exception.
It's a painful process.
After a while.
Well, the best you can do is periodically you take a snapshot, make your decisions the best you can. Second comment, when I look at the 6 schools that are listed as being closed, and this comment sort of goes to Mike Stengel back there, as we plan ahead, which I think we need to get moving on, 3 of the schools and part of 2 of the others go to Edison and Preble. And I think all of us sitting here know how crowded those schools are right right now, and you know, we can't make adjustments overnight, so I would hope we would start looking at that sooner than later.
Thank you.
You're welcome. The final thing that I would say is Joanne Metzler is not at the table. We do a lot of work around open enrollment and in-district transfers, but she lives in central registration, and she does a phenomenal job of keeping track of all of this, giving us the information we need, and making sure everything is all set. So I just wanted to make sure she got a little shout out, because it is a full-time job, and it wasn't intended to be a full-time job when she took it. So.
Anything else? We'll move that forward. Thank you. Next is the sexual harassment violence towards students.
Barb and Jennifer Schultz.
We proposed an update to the policy concerning sexual harassment to add the term sexual violence in its definition. And we also proposed to add a sexual harassment, sexual violence rule. And the reason for this is based on a recommendation by the Department of Education to ensure that we are not in violation of Title IX.
Do they use the term sexual violence? Is that their term?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes.
We really did kind of an overhaul on policy. A lot of what's now going to be in rule was in the old policy. So the new policy is a lot shorter, and then there's the definitions have moved over with the complaint procedure to rule. That's probably in line with our other policies in rule.
Are we ready for questions?
Yes.
Okay. Jess?
Two, if I may. In the policy, it talked about shared with organizations within the community. And I didn't quite follow that line if that meant, here's our policy, we're going to let you know what our policy is, or are we expecting to only deal with other organizations if they follow policies like this?
Well, wasn't it... Was it the line, are you talking about the line where it says all organizations in the community having cooperative agreements with the schools, or which line are you talking about?
I don't have that part in front of me. I just wrote down shared with organizations within the community.
Is this in the policy?
It said it will also be distributed to all organizations in the community having cooperative agreements with the public schools. Is that the statement?
That's what I was asking.
Well, yes, and it doesn't matter whether it's that one or the other one. The question stands. Is that we're just sharing what our policy is with people? Or are we saying a little more than that? This is our policy, and if you discriminate, we're not going to do business with you.
No, we're just sharing what our policy is.
Okay.
Yes.
Although it does say failure to comply with this policy may result in termination of
the
cooperative
agreement. Yeah,
so
I would have answered that. If it's an organization that we have a cooperative agreement with, we're expecting them to follow this policy.
We do put in our contracts that the contractor will not discriminate, so that this policy would follow as part of that agreement.
Okay. The second, may I?
You may.
Yeah.
You always
Thank
have
you.
To. Go ahead.
too much coffee today, folks.
Okay.
In the rules, I don't see it in there. Maybe it's in there, and in terms of violating this policy. We've had situations where one student is in another student's space all the time, and the situation I'm thinking of one in particular right now was really like sort of like sexual intimidation and power by the male involved with females. Now, he didn't touch them. I can't say he said anything, quote unquote, off color, dirty. But he was definitely in their space periodically trying to intimidate them that way. Is that covered in any way in this policy? And you don't have to answer right now. You may have to go back and look at it. Maybe it's there and I didn't see it.
Can I answer?
Yeah, like that very first line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think the issue is his conduct due to because of his sex or the person he's trying to intimidate due to their sex? Mm-hmm. And if that is the case, that the inappropriate behavior, and if we deem the behavior to be inappropriate, was due to the sex of the alleged victim, then it would constitute sexual harassment. The behavior has to be because of sex.
And I guess
The person who's receiving this behavior feels it is this quasi.
It's an objective standard, so it would have to be an objective woman in that position, or it could be a man,
I don't know what you mean by objective. Help me out.
Objective, not reasonable.
Objective would be what the typical population would contend is inappropriate behavior. So, not subjective, but objective.
I think part of what you're asking could be covered in that first line about hostile or intimidating school environment. So I think it's general enough that it could.
Okay.
I think it would be then vetted out through the complaint process whether it did or didn't constitute. So I think my perspective is that the language is general enough to include something of that nature, and that it would need to go through the process to determine whether or not it actually meets what we would consider to be. That's my perspective.
Thank you.
Andrew.
Going to the rule, I guess it's a degree of concern for me that we have something as vague as actions that may offend others is up in the top paragraph, and that's included in the same list as a forcible assault. And my concern is, although I'm sure the process would vet out that there wouldn't be serious career or education altering consequences for a tasteless joke, when we start putting may offend others, what's to stop anyone from virtually anything going to this policy because, A, it was tasteless and it may offend others. It offended me, so it may offend others. Is there really anything that would stop this policy from being triggered or not? Not really.
I think it goes back to that objectionable person standard, and so while it may be offensive to one individual, the way of evaluating it is based on that objectionable person's standard.
Because the rule doesn't say that, though.
Well, that's the legal standard when you evaluate whether these constitute verbal harassment or an inappropriate gesture.
Okay, so despite what we write in our rule that actions that may offend others, you're saying the legal definition would override that?
Actions that may offend others based on an objectionable person standard.
So how many others? I mean, 1% of the population? That's still a lot of others. Of course, but that, do you understand my concern?
Yeah,
I understand.
I'm gonna say, you know, you're gonna say objectionable this standard. I'm gonna say, well, what are you talking about? I can bring 25 people to a meeting that find it very objectionable. I can bring 100.
And that's where the policy and the implementation and the investigation rests with the fact finder and the ultimate reviewer of the facts that are alleged. And that would rest in Jennifer's
So would
office.
There be, it sounds to me like there would be probably almost no time that someone who approached and claimed this policy would be told, come on, this isn't an investigation. Someone flipped you the bird. We're not doing this under this policy. Or would you, I don't know how you couldn't start the policy.
We would have to conduct an investigation.
Okay, so you have to go, you have to investigate under this policy.
Absolutely.
If someone says, I felt blank, you have to.
Absolutely.
But the investigation may conclude quickly if it was an unreasonable. I'm okay with that.
Anything else? Just one thing for me on the policy itself, and maybe it's just me, but I'm not, and I'm beaming myself back to it. It's just the wording that strikes me as a little awkward that the, bear with me.
Behind you.
There we go. Okay. The sexual harassment / violence of students. Sexual harassment of students makes sense to me. Violence of students. It's violence towards students or assault of students, but the violence of students, is, and then maybe it's just me, that it doesn't.
You violate the student.
And the violation of students,
Not
violence of students, or violence towards students. I mean, it doesn't
flow. Yeah, we can change
it. Doesn't flow.
Yeah, okay. We can change
that. Jennifer?
It doesn't, violation of violence, to me.
Yeah, violation and violence are two different.
Right.
Yeah. That's why we're amending this.
Two different connotations. Yeah.
And violence toward.
We
can work on the word.
Violence towards students. It just kind of hit me, and I just.
You may just have to make the sentence longer.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else? Your brow is furrowed.
Yeah. I mean, what's sexual violence?
We have a definition.
The definition is in there.
Yep.
I don't know. You know, I mean, there's an interesting article about these terms that we use in the New York Times about. We parse a lot of these words, and what we're really talking about is rape. So, I don't know. But it's really six of one and a half dozen of the other.
Is this definition, is this, were we given this definition?
It was the definition given by the Department of Education. Yeah, we took their exact definition.
I think that this, which is what you'd said at the outset, that this is what
policy
is defined.
Yeah.
So that's what we're
talking about. Policy funds, and so this is
their exact definition.
And I'm not even sure that in Wisconsin criminal statutes how these things are even parsed. So,
and for us, criminal statutes aren't going to matter. It's going to matter what the Department of Education is going to look at.
You know, we might want to just give them ownership of that saying, as defined by the Department of Education. I mean, just so that it's theirs, not ours.
Okay.
Do we do that? I mean, in other board policy?
I can think
sometimes
of a few other places.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes we do.
I would actually be more comfortable with doing that.
Yeah, I just think then that's give them the ownership.
Well, it's clear then.
Right.
Excuse me. Amplified, I think that I'm saying by or from DPI, but maybe citation, asterisk at the bottom. To cite the source?
Just so that they're acknowledged.
It's in the cross
references.
We could put it in the cross references.
Okay. Sure.
That are on there. And are the legal references?
That's fine. Andrew.
Yeah, I found one more. I'm on the rule again, and we have the. I guess again, my concern is to make sure that this policy is treated with the seriousness that it deserves, and that things that are clearly an inappropriate behavior with no connection to sex don't get pulled into this policy in a big stir and you pursued a case for, you know, this because someone wanted to push it rather than because, I guess here's my question. When you say sexual violence, this includes but is not limited to physical acts perpetrated against a person's will or incapable of consent, etc. That first sentence includes a whole lot of things that are not sexual, because that wasn't even mentioned in the first sentence. Is the second sentence, acts that fall into the category include 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is the second sentence a limiter of the first sentence? For example, someone could walk up to a stranger and kick them really, really hard in the shin. Okay, that's a physical act perpetrated against a person's will. Does the second sentence eliminate that because there was no connection whatsoever to a sexual behavior, or not necessarily? And I realize this is pretty hypothetical, but again, it goes towards trying to prevent abuse of a policy and a distraction from a very serious problem.
So, do I hear you saying that it should say this includes?
Perhaps, well, I'm not.
But
it's
not limited to
physical sexual
acts perpetrated against a person.
Except I understand that that might not be exactly correct either, because something can be.
Is it?
I guess I'm asking Anne more from a legal perspective. Did the second sentence filter the first?
I think it's intended to help more clearly define what it could include, not.
We have another policy that protects from general violence,
uh-huh.
not sexual
yeah,
violence.
We do. Yeah.
So then the first sentence mm-hmm. actually maybe is too broad.
I wondered about that.
Right.
That's kind of where I was going.
Maybe it's a physical sexual act.
Right.
And then maybe to ensure that we're not limiting in the other direction, maybe you need a reference in here to say, you know, other types of violence determined not to fall under this category may still. Maybe
that would be the cross reference on
us.
I guess I'm thinking about something a little more, maybe a little bit of narration, which is more than just a cross section policy number.
Okay.
Because then I think it's good to make a distinction here that, you know, if someone kicks you several times below the knee, we will take it seriously. But we will not have someone just try to push it down this policy to make it sound worse.
Sure.
Okay. Anything else? Great, nothing else? Thank you very much.
Yes. We're back with an update. Really, Melissa provided as part of her legal updates a few months ago, I believe, an indication that we'd be working on this scholarship. So we're asking the board to consider updates to policy 460 and the corresponding rules. I'll just walk you through a little bit of what we're asking you to look at with the rules. Rule 1, which is identified as guidelines for the selection of academic excellence higher education scholarship recipients, is simply being revised. We have that currently in process right now, but we're just tweaking that a little bit to include this new scholarship opportunity. Whereas rule number 2, which is titled guidelines for the selection of technical excellence scholarship recipients, is new, and it's in response to changes by Wisconsin Act 60 that was put out in 2013. The State of Wisconsin Higher Education Aids Board did not release details regarding this creation of the policy or rule until November 2014, which is why we have a quick turnaround to put policy in place and and provide the opportunity for our students to take advantage of that. We did give you an update this last week, I believe, in the board updates, and provided an attachment so that you had a little bit more information regarding the Technical Excellence Scholarship, and it was a summary that was there. I will highlight this, that this scholarship is an opportunity for our students, and it's worth up to $2,250 per year for up to 6 total semesters. The scholarship would be utilized at any participating Wisconsin Technical College. So we had a work group that we put together to work on this, and members of that work group included Melissa, Barb Dorf participated, Lori Peacock participated, Mike Fries and Angela Buckenhauer participated. I'm gonna turn it over to Mike and Angela. They did the heavy lifting on this policy, and certainly would be able to provide any comments, and then we would open it up to any questions that the board would have.
Thank you. I would offer also as a point of introduction that we anticipate significant heavy lifting to continue these next few months and over the next year and going forward based on how it plays out across the state. This is we're very excited about this opportunity, I would say, because it means recognizing excellence in additional areas in our students' educational experience and in areas that we've been emphasizing as a district, which is quite, you know, quite nice to see. Essentially, you know, from a teaching and learning perspective, this is an opportunity for more of our students to earn a significant scholarship, as Mr. Smith indicated. It recognizes excellence beyond academic achievement by outlining the additional factors and requirements in order to be eligible. So that's one thing you'll notice in the comparison of the general policy and then the revision of a rule compared to the new rule. There's you probably noticed quite a bit of difference in between the two. Also, this emphasizes the sort of excellence that we see with our students who engage in such eligibility criteria, including things such as particular concentration of courses in career and technical education, as defined by the state and spelled out in the rule and in our course book for students who are signing up and focusing in such areas, as well as students who are basically declaring an interest in a particular career pathway or career cluster or career field as part of a program of study. Moving into a technical college experience, and also demonstrating potentially student leadership by participating with a career technical education student organization. So a lot of the factors you see spelled out in the rule that could be our eligibility criteria, I really kind of talk about that well-roundedness that we would see from our candidates that will be identified. And now some additional current heavy lifting and moving forward what Angela's been communicating and working through. I'd like to talk a little bit about that.
Well, the heavy lifting will come as we try to implement this policy. As you can see, it's not nearly as clear-cut as the Academic Excellence Scholarship. There are much more criteria for eligibility and then many more criteria to earn points to be awarded the scholarship. So we have been working diligently with the stakeholders at the buildings to clarify how do we define these pieces, how are we going to quantify these pieces. We've been working very closely with technology to see if we can efficiently run reports to gather this data so that it's not, we don't by human error miss. Unfortunately, not all of these are easily accessed, so we're trying very hard to create multiple actually reports so that we can be cross-referencing and that we're not missing students. And unfortunately, the state did not give us a whole lot of lead time in trying to create these reports, so people are have been working very hard on all ends to get this. And once we kind of get going with this, we will be throwing it out or pushing it out to the buildings and working again with the counselors who are in charge of the scholarship programs at each of the high schools to identify and to promote it to students to make sure that we're getting the right candidates and that we are following all the processes so that all the students can be that are eligible will be on that list. So we're very excited about it.
Any questions?
Brenda.
As we move forward, obviously not this year as much, but is this something that we will communicate to students what the criteria are for earning the scholarship so that if they're one CTE course shy or, you know, something like that and they have a real interest in attending a technical college that they know that, you know, that they have a shot at doing that. Is that something that's in the work or you're planning for ongoing? And then do you have a list of all of our CTE, all the classes that our students can take that qualify for the scholarship?
Yes. Yes, and we've been very diligent in all of the different points that make eligible of creating the list of all of the programs, working with Lori Peacock and the CTE team leaders to make sure that we are not missing anything, and so we're checking and cross-checking to make sure that we have all of those and clarifying what all of those definitions mean.
Because I would be, once that's done, I'd be interested in, I think other board members just, you know, to know if people ask us which classes can qualify for that scholarship. And then, two more questions. At the very beginning of the rule, it says something about shall apply exclusively to the scholars designated during the 2014-15 school year. Does that mean that this is for this year and we're going to run it through and see how it goes and write another or tweak it for the following year, or what does that mean?
The recommendation, because the, as you may recall from when I provided you the update, if the board could adopt what the higher ed board put out as the criteria, or we could go it our own way and set forth our own criteria, that had to be approved by the higher ed board, I believe it was in December. So they didn't give a lot of time.
Okay.
So what we've done to make clear for our own students for the following school year, as you indicated, we need to communicate this out so that they can start building towards the scholarship. We didn't want anyone to falsely rely on what we're establishing for 14-15 for the following year. So we may stick with this, but we wanted to make sure that we were clear in the rule for students going forward that these requirements could change.
Okay. Yeah. And then on page numbers. There's one. I think it's 3 on my computer. It's number 5. Oh no, number 6. Mm-hmm. Under, sorry. This is a long list. District requirements when you may compete. So it's a long list. Mm-hmm. Number 6. I read that through a number of times and couldn't figure out what it was telling me. If somebody could elaborate on that.
You won't be able to get the scholarship. But.
Okay, well, yes. That's the criteria. You didn't put that in here. If you can't understand this paragraph, forget it.
So one of the challenges when establishing criteria for senior status, we did dialogue a lot around how do you define senior status, and so this isn't, Melissa, please clarify if I have this aspect wrong, because it is wordy. It's not intended to throw people off, but it's intended to give the district leeway and clarity around when a student becomes eligible to compete for this. It's kind of, I would say, sort of cross-connected to possibility of early graduation or holding out for an extra semester for some reason, what I choose to do in the summer. And I think that this is one of those, like, how do we define when you're a senior and when you can put your name in the hat for this? Okay. We're anticipating that there will be, because of the point system, because of there's going to be a number of students who are going to be in the running for this, and I think we're curious about how specifically we define parameters.
So this is to prevent someone taking a fifth year of high school and then applying in their fifth
year. So if we're competing and I say, oh, if I can't beat you, but I know I can beat the student next year, and if I graduate at the semester, first semester time, so I'm going to delay my graduation.
Okay.
Well, no. So that number 6 is avoiding that process of saying, oh, I know I can't win now, but I know I'm pretty sure I could win next year.
And also, to some extent, this is our now interpretation of what the higher ed board has offered as sample as well. So we're speculating a little bit, and we, you know, relative to what their intentions are around that piece as well. But we believe it was to provide us that kind of protection around that.
Okay. Andrew.
Okay, I guess I think I have a pretty clear understanding looking at the rules here about the academic excellence. So the seventh semester ranking.
Where are you looking?
Rule 460 R1.
Oh, R1. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm comparing 1 and 2. It seems to me one is pretty clear. If Kim has a 4.0 and Mark has a 3.99 and I have a 3.97, I'm an alternate. You're the winners. done, right? That's it.
Glad you got that in the right order.
So, all right. So then if we both have, if we both have 398s, then we look at the other things. Okay. So if I jump over to Rule 2 for the technical scholarship, where there's a lot of other criteria we're talking about. So if Mark has a 4.0 and Kim has a 3.99 and I have a 3.98 and we're going for the technical scholarship, we don't know for sure yet until we make sure that we did at least one of the item three things, of which there's many. So if, and then if at that point Mark was a CTE concentrator and took a ton of technical courses, I participated in FFA off of a single course enrollment, and Kim did youth apprenticeship. Even though I did a smaller thing, I did one of them. We're all in this together, and now I'm out and you're in. Or if, is that correct? So it's almost completely driven. It's almost completely driven by grade point, or grade point as a percentage of a formula?
I think
go ahead.
I believe that the difference between the two is grade point average is a qualifying factor for the Academic Excellence Scholarship. Grade point average is a tiebreaker in the Technical Excellence Scholarship. That's
so when you're looking at the Technical Excellence Scholarship, the overall GPA at first, each student is part of the tiebreaker, so if they made it to the tiebreaker, they would go number one GPA. In order to gain points for the Technical Excellence Scholarship, because that is based not on GPA but on overall points, we would be taking the GPA from CTE courses only. We would take that earns you so many points. You also earn points if you're in youth apprenticeship courses. You earn points for every CTE course you're in. You earn points for every organization you're in. So there are many more things to consider in the Technical Excellence Scholarship to gain points. So it's really about a point system. So I might have 15 points, Mike has 14 points, I win. If we both have 15 points, then we're going to the tiebreakers, which we're all looking at overall GPA. So if I have a if Mike has a 4.0 and I have a 3.98, Mike wins, and I would be the alternate at that point.
Okay, so I could have a 2.0 average, and you could have a 3.99 average.
And you might win.
But I took one half more credit and did much less active CSTOs, and I still win.
Well, it's all based on points, so it would be a matter of how those points. I don't imagine that someone with a lower grade point average plus only a half a credit more of CTE courses would get more points at that point, because your grade point average in your CTE courses is one of the point qualifiers, and that's how you're earning points.
You're using multiple data points.
Right, we have multiple points.
What counts for what, though? Because if we go into the, and I misspoke a little bit on that. So it says awarding points for CTE courses, half a point for each half credit earned, so you have to pass it, and 1 point for each year of activity in a CTSO. And we count credits in progress as earned. So there's your points, right? So if I won on points, we don't even look further.
Can
correct.
I clarify, Angela?
Oh, sure.
Okay, because if you look, Andrew, and the designating scholars and alternates, and on, I think that's page 2 of the rule, and if you look at number 3, for purposes of ranking the qualified scholarship candidates and designating scholars and alternates, the district adopts the point system established by the higher ed board, under which the student's grade point average in the CTE courses serves as the initial tiebreaker if you have identical points. So if that's the initial tiebreaker, you don't get points for your grade point average.
Yep, you're right.
You get points on the next page, 1, 2, and 3 is where the points are awarded. If you and I have the same points, then our grade point average in our CTE courses is the initial tiebreaker. If we're still tied, then we're going to those tie-breaking procedures, which are on page 5. And that, and then the second tiebreaker is our cumulative grade point average.
So if I have 0.5 point more than you because of one extra semester of stuff,
yes,
with a 2.0 average,
you could still,
I will win.
You win.
Mm-hmm. And that's done. And there isn't a formula that combines grade point. I just have to pass.
That's not, so remember, we're adopting the higher ed board
right.
procedures, and then that's why we're doing it for a year, see how this works out. And then we can go back and look at something like that. But the higher ed board will have to approve any alternate point system and ranking system.
Okay, so I'm just,
correct.
Just mm-hmm. making that
yep.
clear.
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
This is going to be presented to students in a way that you don't need a law degree to figure out.
Well, first we're going to try to present it to staff so that they understand that they don't need a law degree to figure
first.
It out as well. So
I already failed the law degree because I didn't get the paragraph.
But Katie, I think you bring up a good point. We need to operationalize it, and I think that's the goal of this year, being able to adopt the recommendation, be able to go through it this year, and then to be able to make a decision. Do we want to stay with this, or do we want to put forth different criteria? And it's unfortunate we had a quick turnaround, but we saw the opportunity for our students as an opportunity that we didn't want to pass up. Yep.
It's good to just take them and be able to offer it.
Yeah.
Even though you may have, especially on the technical side, an more likely have an unexpected result. Mm-hmm. I'd rather take that chance than not do it or get our criteria denied.
Yep.
Chris.
Somebody mentioned human error, and several people are going to be involved in trying to operationalize this. So more people we have, the greater the chance, and it will happen. Mm-hmm. So I guess my question is, as you look at what is there from the state, is the district held harmless if we make an error and one of you get it that somebody else should have? I mean, what happens? Maybe you don't have an answer to that right now, but I guess I'd like to know if we're, what our liability was is with this, if any.
Well, I think it's the same liability. I know from personal experience there's been disputes over the academic excellence scholarship as well, and so we'll have to just work through that, and the state will not indemnify us for making a mistake, so we will have to work through that and make sure that what we certify to the state is correct, and if we make a mistake, then we'll have to work with the state to figure out how we correct that mistake. So what is our liability? I don't know at this point.
We'll get it right.
I have one more. I overlooked the in the tiebreaker on the academic scholarship. AP is included in points, but IB isn't. Is tiebreaker credits, is that right? Sure?
I don't think we changed the tiebreaker credits for that.
I'm just wondering, that seems a little strange, even though we're not competing cross schools, and I get that. You have IB schools with less chances to take AP. So am I at a competitive advantage in an IB school by not doing the IB program in order to take a couple of, it seems that we try to, although they're different, we try to consider them as different tracks of equal
AP, IB.
Rigor.
Yep.
So as the, I don't know if there's the potential to ask for a quick decision and turnaround to be able to add IB into this, or if it's too late.
I would guess, my guess is, based on my years of experience in school counseling, it's too late to change it for this year, because usually the criteria has to be shared out. So if you're looking at this year's graduating class, to now go back and say, and we're going to add IB to this tiebreaker, I think we would probably not be in a good spot.
But didn't we not yet approve it?
Well, but kids have gotten this information shared with them for years.
The academic scholar, we made no changes for the tiebreakers for the academic excellence. That's been here for years and years and years and years. That's the old rule.
So that rule, maybe we overlooked that rule in the process of many, many things we were doing to get IB ready.
Well, in 2008,
Did we have IB in 2008? That's the last time it was revised.
No.
I don't think we did.
No.
So that's probably why it's not, because I was involved
not,
with revising
well,
it.
So that's not good. We should have whatever the fair point is, you know, going forward from some point, we should
that,
try to get those counted.
Yeah. And that would, to me, that's a transitional piece, because many kids come in as freshmen and sophomores aligning themselves to figure out how to get this scholarship. So if I came in as a sophomore thinking this is the criteria, and now 2 years from now, you almost are going to have to roll it so that it's the new kids coming in as freshmen who have that new criteria.
That's unfortunate, but probably less bad than
that. So a great thing for us to look at, but it could be 4 years out before we see
counting,
it.
Counting pluses and minuses will create less tiebreaker situations, probably.
Sure.
Anything else? We'll move that forward. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thanks. Thank you, Angela.
You want to schedule?
Yes.
Probably have scheduled.
This is another one.
Yeah,
could I see that look again?
What we have scheduled,
what we have scheduled is her evaluation, not a
Michelle's
retreat.
Evaluation, not a retreat.
Okay. Thank you.
So let's just look right away at February 9th.
What is Michelle's evaluation?
That's not too early for you, Michelle.
Six.
I mean, you can have what you need ready by the night.
Where? Can we have what we need ready by the night?
I didn't hear the date. I'm sorry.
February 9th. Does that give you enough time to prepare for the retreat?
Yeah.
I forgot what the retreat.
I think so. Five is left. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Plenty of time.
So, can any? Is there anyone who cannot meet on the 9th?
Oh yeah.
You?
That's cool. No,
no, no.
I'll show up whenever you need.
All right. All right. So looks like February 9th will work. I guess then the question of time.
Yeah, for sure.
You like
the 9th. It's going to be around J.
Okay.
Hall, and
so
it's any scheduling
start at
options
six?
Update.
Does that work for everybody?
No.
All right. That was a record, I think.
I think it was.
Anticipate 2 hours?
That should be plenty.
That's plenty.
What time are you starting?
6 o'clock.
6:58 on the 9th.
Yeah, it's
all
probably
right.
Not even that long, but it depends.
Mm-hmm.
We could have something.
That's the evaluation or the retreat?
No, that's
the
retreat.
The evaluation,
evaluation
is, the
is yeah, 2 weeks from tonight.
At 5:15.
Oh, because the board meetings do the holiday where the second and third instead of the first and
right.
Third.
Right.
It's
right.
Second. Okay.
Right.
Right. Okay. And that completes our work session.
All right. Thank you, Katie. Do we want to take a break?
Yes.
5 minutes? Let's do that. Come back at 7:45.
So organizational support work session, we have three discussion items. The first one under business and finance is purchase of property south of Leonardo da Vinci K-8 school.
Okay, what we're bringing to you today is to look at purchasing property south of da Vinci on the corner of Doty and Quincy. Tonight we have Cheryl Raynard Wig with us. She is with Green Bay City's Planning and Community Development, and I asked Cheryl to come tonight to answer any questions you have regarding this. We're looking at purchasing this property to expand our site. The building was originally designed for 250 students. We started off this year around 280. Is that correct, Kim? Somewhere around there. So the site is very small. The playground, we're short on parking for staff because the staff is larger than what we originally had planned on. So what we'd be looking at the site for is to expand some of our outdoor space, especially some green space for a playground, some asphalt place for maybe like a basketball court or something like that, and then some additional teacher parking. So that would be our immediate plan for this area. So what we gave to you is that there is, I believe, about 9 different parcels, and we had budgeted in this year's budget to buy these parcels and then to relocate the tenants. And that's what Cheryl's here to answer any questions on that process.
The information isn't here. It was in, I think, our board update. There was a reference to what the relocation costs would be, and I thought there was like $38,000. It said we could avoid that by giving 6-month notice. But my concern is, are there residents or people there who would be, who would we should relocate and not just wait 6 months and then have them vacate? You know what my question is? Is that, are there people there that need for us to help them find another place to live?
At this point, we don't know who's actually living in the units. We know tenant or owner. I believe there's one owner in this stretch of property. The rest are tenants. And regarding the relocation benefits, it's really, tenants are not entitled to relocation benefits anymore under the state if you give them proper notice of either 6 months or the end of their lease term, whichever is longer. So, and I need to point out too on this, data you've got up here, we've actually adjusted the relocation because of the, when we prepared these documents, we thought there might be some federal funding involved, and there won't be. It sounds like it's just going to be the school district dollars, which means that that's how we can bring the relocation costs down on the tenants. So if this is actually dated, we think the relocation costs are going to be close to $62,000.
Okay, I just want to make sure that we treat people living in those residences fairly and not just give them 6 months and say, you know, see ya.
Well, with early conversations with Cheryl, you know, we could give them incentives like, you know, $500 or something like that, which would be, you know, almost a month's rent possibly for some people, which, you know, if they know that they are going to have to move and that we would give them an incentive, they may, you know, want to move sooner than later. So we could look at, you know, that would be our option. If we wouldn't be required to, but we could option, you know.
I just want to make sure we treat them fairly. I guess that's my bottom line.
So your point, Cheryl, is that if the 6 months or the end of their lease, whichever is longer, if someone has a year left, just renewed their lease, has a year left on it, then we might want to incentivize them.
We cannot force them to move, but we can say to them, hey, you know, if you're out in 6 months, we can give you $500. Or, you know, you can give them incentives to move, but you can't force them to move. I mean, I'm going to guess that these are month-to-month leases in this area. Pretty sure they're probably month-to-month leases. So in a month-to-month tenancy, tenants are, you know, we're required to give a 30-day notice. Landlords have to give the tenants 30 days notice. So 6 months is really generous. And then we also work with them. I mean, if it's a situation where they have a voucher, you know, we work with them with ICS to help to move them. So, it sounds, you know, like we give you the notice, but we really don't. We meet with the people on site, we explain the situation, and we give them proper notice and incentives if we need to. The owner, though, will need to be relocated. There's one owner, so we actually will have to do a relocation plan.
The one who's owner-occupied?
Owner-occupied, correct.
Okay.
Because under the state, you still have to pay relocation benefits to owners. So that will need a plan, and there'll be a full benefit package along with acquisition of that property.
Okay. And that's for one person. What's the relocation expense for?
It's one of those things where we won't know until we get into the plan.
Oh, okay.
All I estimated were the maximums. Rarely, if ever, do you get a maximum. There's a number of different relocation benefits that they can receive as the owners, differential payments between homes, moving, closing costs, those types of things.
Chris? Mike, how sooner are you
hoping to have the people, or have that property available, I should say?
Well, we'd like to have it vacant the summer sometime so we could prep the site and, you know, have it ready in fall. But it, I mean, it won't take us, you know, long. And, you know, realistically, if it's not, you know, if we don't have the parking lot or the playground completely ready for the beginning of school, I mean, we'll continue on using the site the way we have been and then, you know, be able to move into it.
Is there an advantage to the district to have them out sooner in terms of hiring folks for demolition? Or anything like that in terms of the market might be like now as compared to summer?
No, I mean, in summer, once the weather gets nicer, it's easier to, you know, remove foundations and, you know, do the work once the, you know, weather is better.
Well, I'd hate to disrupt families with school-aged children if they're attending one of our schools and then put them out during the school year.
I was looking for is a trade-off in terms of what we might be able to save by them moving sooner, as to what we could comfortably potentially offer them before moving sooner.
Yeah, I don't think there's a big advantage if they move in March or April or if it's in June.
They'll have 6 months from whenever this body decides to proceed, if they decide to proceed. So 6 months would take them well into summer, if they decide to stay that long.
Right.
With regards to school-age kids.
So it appears there are 2 lots and 6 structures. Are we raising these structures, or are any of them structurally sound enough that they could be moved, sold?
Won't know until we get into them, I guess.
Okay.
Question.
What we have done in the past, I mean, and this is the third or fourth time we have, I know we did it at Lincoln and Fort Howard and at Preble. We looked at the structures and we did have a few, you know, brought in movers and people that, you know, purchased it. Sometimes you're better off, you know, getting hardly anything and having them move it than pay the cost of demoing it. So, I mean, we'll offer it to people if they want to take a look at it and move the structure.
Could we donate to Habitat for Humanity if they were interested, if the house is movable?
You could, but
I
can't speak for Habitat, but just I've had recent meetings with them, and they're really they want to do new builds.
New builds.
Yeah. Moving these houses, some of them are quite large. It's going to be very expensive, and you have to have the lot close.
Right.
You can't get in through Webster. You know, that's very limited to the donation of properties in this neighborhood and where you go with them. We do have a lot on Quincy, though, actually, when you say that. The RDA owns a lot on South Quincy, so if one of these larger homes actually get into it and it could be rehabbed, that is potential
that
to move
potential.
It to that site. Yep.
Okay.
I have several items, but I was allowing others to go first. Can you give me just the basic cliff notes of the relocation value, unit size, or what kinds of things go into that?
Relocation benefits for owners would be, okay, think about this. It's, I know it really well, but it's a difficult concept. Basically, you have to make the owner whole again. So we look at the value of the structure based off of appraisal. And then we go out and find comparables for that property. And based on the value of the comparables compared to what the value of the property that they live in, the difference, if there is any, between those two numbers is a payment we make available to that person so they're able to take what we pay them for the property and this difference and go out and buy a house. That's one section of that relocation. They also can get a moving payment based on the number of rooms in the structure. And they have a choice of either a fixed payment, number of rooms, or we hire a mover, we pay everything. That's the moving, and then if they choose to buy something else, we pay for the closing costs on the purchase. So, I mean, it's a very nice package for owners.
I think it seems like it's a pretty good package for owners. Now,
mm-hmm.
how is it determined for tenants if you don't give 6 months?
if you decide to relocate a tenant.
Right.
That can be very costly. It depends. There's a number of factors. If they are a low-income tenant, for example, that kind of comparable that I told you about the owners applies for the tenant. Rent here, rent for the comparable place. If they are a low-income tenant paying low rent here, and in order to move them into a decent, safe, and sanitary property here, that difference in payment can be quite large. We always try to work with tenants to get them a voucher if they're low income, and so that, you know, helps to move them. But that difference, you know, can be up to, I'm thinking, it's $8,000 for the state. For federal, luckily you guys aren't using the federal money, there's no cap. So we've actually had to make payments of $15,000 to $16,000 of tenants. And then moving is the same thing, room or actual moving cost. So, but in this instance, I mean, I think with your timelines, 6 months is, I mean, it's been enough time for a tenant to move generally with our system.
So I think it's been made clear how we dodge giving a tenant anything after taking them out of their home and it's legal. I think that's pretty clear. 6 months, you don't have to give them anything. And then we're talking about, well, maybe we'll incentivize with $500.
I don't think dodge is an appropriate word, though, because they're not eligible for those benefits. So we're not dodging a benefit. They are not eligible under the state law for those relocation benefits.
If we wait 6 months.
If you give them the proper notices, right. You know, if you've got some developer coming in, for example, or actually it doesn't even really apply for developer, it's really for municipal or school district types of purchases now. But if you needed to be in the ground, let's say, April 1st, well then, yeah, then it's a full-blown relocation. Then they generally have 90 days, so half of that time. They still get 90 days as tenants if we relocate them.
Okay, so if I'm a tenant without a voucher, mm-hmm. what happens to me? If we give the 6 months, what does the city do? What does the school district do? What happens? Or is it just find a new place to go rent?
We'd talk to you, we'd find out your situation, what's going on, and you'd get a letter, 6 month notice to vacate. Or whatever that time frame is, if it's longer with regards to the lease. So six month notice to vacate.
So if I can't find a landlord, then I'm homeless? Or is the city, you know, is the city going to do something to ensure that I get a landlord or not?
Well, we work with the tenants. We've never created a homeless person through our projects over the last 27 years I've been doing this. So I would say to you, if we were to get to the point of 6 months where for some reason we couldn't find or they couldn't find a place to rent, I mean, I think I'd have contact with you. I'd say, okay, here's a situation. We've got this difficult tenant, difficult rental situation. What would you like us to do? But I guess we've got a rental market that's pretty good in Green Bay, so.
Sure, I was the team leader for emergency assistance for a long time, for a solid year. But I've certainly seen situations where people had to accept places of last, I won't name names, but places of last resort because of police calls that may have not been their fault, because of credit scores that may have involved people other than themselves. Well, regardless of why. Now, I feel better that you're saying they've never created a homeless person in 27 years of this. You have a 27-year track record of finding a landlord every, and this would be hundreds of people, I'm assuming, hundreds and hundreds of people. So I do feel better about that track record, but I think for me to be able to say, let's go ahead with this, I'm going to need to know that someone, and if that someone is us, you know, are we going to make the commitment that as a last resort, we would put someone up at a cost of $10,000 and make sure they're taken care of for a year if all other means have failed. I need to know that because that's not a lot of money when the owner occupied is going to get a very nice settlement. I guess that's my concern, and I think maybe maybe it falls to us to make that decision, but I need to know that that contingency is covered.
Well, you, I mean, you, as the board, could choose to relocate all the tenants if you wanted to make that decision and say that, look, we'd really like these houses down, you know, by June, less than the 6 months. You, as the board, could say, I want to proceed with relocation. At that point, we would do a full-blown plan with every tenant and proceed from there. It's just, it's not, just what I'm telling you is not something that you have to do.
Right.
If you choose to do that, you could do that, and we could certainly provide those benefits. But I guess in my experience, we've been, I mean, if you just, the corner of Monroe and Chicago, mm-hmm. if you're familiar with that,
yeah.
we had a number
yeah.
of difficult
yeah.
right. tenants, difficult to relocate tenants, and we found places for all of them. So, I mean, I feel like I'm pretty confident that we can help tenants move.
I mean, you know, because Cheryl has been doing this for some time, and she works downtown. So the tenants that she relocates, including when I was the alderman in my district, I mean, she does a very good job. I think that if there were an issue, that Cheryl would come back to us through Mike and through Melissa and maybe...
And Patterson,
to let us know that there is an issue with the tenant, and then we could act accordingly. I feel comfortable, Andrew, saying that we're going to entrust the process to Cheryl and her staff over at the city, because they've been doing this for a really long time. They know the area. And let me just say, too, I mean, I am unfamiliar with the tenants in that area. I cannot recall if my district kind of snaked. It's my district snaked through there, but I can't. You know, sometimes people are just happy to leave, and given an opportunity, you know, they get a good, you know, they're not leaving because police calls, they're not leaving because of credit issues, they're leaving because the lease was terminated because the property was sold to the school district, and so sometimes they're looking for, you know, a way out. But I feel comfortable in trusting at least the initial process. If there's an issue, like I said, I'm sure, mm-hmm. I'm confident that she's going to come back to us and say there's an issue that we need to address.
But I feel better knowing that it's happened zero times mm-hmm. versus I would have
right.
thought no matter what, there would have been 5% of the time we mm-hmm. had to relocate her.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel better about that. But ultimately, in the end, it's us. It, right, it would be on us. If we're going to choose to give the 6 months, then we don't have to, at the end of the 6 months, we could do nothing. So I'd like to know what we would be planning to do as that theoretical contingency. Because otherwise I'm still voting for something that, however unlikely, could leave a person not,
mm-hmm.
not resettled by the city and not obligated to be paid by us. Unlikely though that is, I'd like to know that contingency is covered.
I understand that, but I'm not comfortable putting a dollar amount down, a lump sum
yeah.
that we're going to,
no,
before we wait until the system, I'd rather have, you know, let it play out. I am concerned, will people get, if they have security deposits, will they get those back?
Well, one of the things, right, I mean, that's what, I have to tell you that often there's no security deposit.
Yeah. Right.
One of the things we can
right.
do is offer to pay a security deposit. At the new place, which helps them, you know, because it's hard to get
just
that security deposit gathered to get into that rent.
Because sometimes having to get 2 months
yep.
worth of rent
right.
is formidable, and if you can just, if we can
so
help them
we
that
have
way.
Done that. We've provided, like I told you about those incentives, we've provided that security deposit when we've needed to do that in the past.
Yeah.
You know, we've worked with the tenants, and sometimes we've got a difficult relocation going on right now, as a matter of fact, on Chicago Street, where, you know, we're really in contact with them every week. You know, when
yeah.
we're seeking out places for them to go, and so we have the same goal. I mean, with the neighborhood
oh, right,
division,
just,
we
right.
don't. I mean, our goal, we don't ever want to create a homeless person ever. So,
no.
we you know we're very hands-on when we do this. Some communities don't; they really don't care. But I think we, as the city, have always cared about that.
And
so.
Cheryl also knows the lay of the land in terms of properties and landlords in town, and so she has a body. Yes.
I also supervise the housing inspectors.
Yes. Yes,
yes.
I mean, you're connected. You can get them through this.
I caught that.
Process.
Connected.
Sure.
And again, this is just a discussion. It's really mm-hmm. not to vote on what right. we're going to do. So,
right.
But we are. But we
the
are.
The discussion
gonna...
is to hear what yeah. your thoughts are, so then we can come back with mm-hmm. come back to the board with a plan.
If I may, a possible solution to this, the individual who owns, we will have to pay for those relocation costs. You could make a motion next week that you would authorize up to a certain amount for the tenants for the district to allocate and spend for the relocation, such as the security deposits that Cheryl has talked about, and maybe some other intangible things.
Moving costs. Some small fee
authorize
for that
up
or...
to a certain amount, and then if when Cheryl's working with the tenants, it would exceed or we wouldn't need to spend that amount, we could come back to the board and ask for additional monies for the board to spend.
So would you have a count by our board meeting about how many tenants there are?
I'm pretty sure we know how many tenants there are right now. I think we have to decide. I think one of the things you need to look at is which ones we want to purchase. I know there's one on the end, which is the 222 South Quincy. That's actually owned by ICS, and it's a duplex right now. It's actually not a bad looking property on the end. It'd be on the very end of your project, so whether or not you choose to buy that one or not is, you know, you have to decide on that. But I understand that is kind of a group home. Both of the units are occupied by some challenged individuals. So that one may be a difficult move, and that we'll need to find the right circumstances and the right move, and that might be one you decide not to pick up. So I'll need some guidance with regards to that. But that's on the very end of the project,
the,
I think.
Yeah, so that,
and that one is, I don't know if you really actually need that one or not. Might
no, we wouldn't have to have it. I mean, I guess what we would look at is we'd, you know, try to work an offer, and if they accepted, fine. If they didn't and it became a problem, we just wouldn't go that far, so.
But that's gonna be a hands-on move. We won't be able
sure.
to just issue a notice on that one. We'll actually have to work directly with the tenants on that one and be very hands-on property management situation.
Because of certain rules, or because we're going to do it because it's the right thing to do and it would be hard, or?
Because it's the right thing to do.
Okay.
I mean, if I'm just following the rules, I'm giving them a notice.
You could, if you're just following the rules,
6 month notice.
Just, okay.
Where is that on this map, that property?
It's.
Bring the other one up.
It's 222, so it's the furthest one to the south.
That doesn't create a flagship shaped lot,
no.
does it?
No.
I don't think so.
I mean, flag lot.
Nope.
No.
Because you're squaring off anyway. It's just one less parcel to the south.
So if we were to do that property, the hands-on move, which is good,
mm-hmm.
is if we gave the 6 months, but we're still going to do a hands-on
mm-hmm.
relocation, as you call it. Is that with your funding, or I'm not opposed to funding it, but city funding or our funding?
No, the one right above there.
That's our funding, because we're buying it. Okay. So you would be recommending a hands-on move and giving us a budget for it that's reasonable and the right thing to do.
Yeah.
We could vote for get it. We probably wouldn't, but
right.
that could happen, though. And I guess that's, I don't suspect that any board member, current or incoming, would say no to paying a reasonable settlement. But I like things to be a little more cut and dried when I vote yes on it, I guess.
And I have to be honest with you, our look at this has really been off of what we can find on our databases and computer. We haven't done any outreach to anyone there at this point. So, I mean, it's. There's more fact finding to do if you're interested in that. And with regards to, you know, it's been a while since we've acquired for the district. I'm not sure which the last one was.
It was Preble.
Preble Park. So I don't know exactly what role you'd like us to play too with regards to at what point do we turn the property over to the district. You know, when we do something, we go in there, it's a relocation plan or it's dealing with the tenants. We do the acquisition, relocation, property management, and then we turn it over to the district in the past. Here, it's ready to go, tear it down. You know what I mean? So we haven't really even talked about that yet either with regards to what you want us to do. Maybe at some point, you know, Mike's like, okay, as soon as you send the notices out, then hand it over, or, you know, I don't know. We have to talk about that.
Okay.
No, I think we'd
go through
the same,
want, but.
Same process, and because, you know, you have more of the expertise to bring this.
A couple comments and two questions of technical nature. I personally don't have any problem with some sort of incentive to help people move. If we do that, I would like some sort of time frame there that it's not ad nauseum. Wrong term, but it wouldn't go on and on. In any event, is my memory serves me right, isn't there a certain distance where the homeowner can buy a comparable property? It's not like they can go to Wausau or?
They can go wherever they want. We only have to pay moving up to 50 miles.
Moving up to how far?
50 miles.
50 miles.
50 mile radius, but they can.
So if I'm looking at a comparable house in Chicago?
I look at comparables. We provide a plan. We look at a comparable property closest to their property with the same makeup. So the numbers are based on a comparable. I don't think anyone has ever moved to one of our comparables because they, of course, they choose the place they want to live. They usually upgrade, to be honest with you. They don't go into the exact same small two-bedroom. When they have the opportunity, they upgrade. So.
Okay, sure.
If that clarifies it.
Okay. The I understand it for the homeowner that's living in that home.
Mm-hmm.
How about the owner of a property that's not living there? Do we have to offer them this comparable in terms of if they want to buy a new property?
Mm-mm.
Okay.
No.
So we would be voting on this next week.
Yes.
Will this kind of fact finding information be available by next week, or is that unreasonable? I mean, it sounds like there's quite a project.
What facts are you looking for? I would have to ask you.
Number of tenants. Approximate would be good. If we're going to talk about possibly setting a dollar amount for relocation and other types of expenses, then we would need to know about how many tenants there are.
I can probably give
households,
you that.
Not individuals,
right.
Households.
I can probably give you that today depending on what you're going to purchase. So on this sheet that you saw up there, we have the actual number of units according to the tax record. So. We could go do a visual mailbox count in case we miss something, an illegal conversion or something. But
3, 6, plus 8 is 6 is 12.
Well, in these living units, we have, for example, it's listed 4 for that Bay Oaks, that 222. There's really 2 units there. It's a duplex side by side. So
that's 10. The one. That's the.
That's
the
group, right.
So that's not necessary. Those are individuals and not necessarily households.
Well, 2 living units, so it would be the household within the unit that you're looking at.
I would let me piggyback on your comments. In terms of the dollar figure for moving, I guess I would ask for a reasonable figure to be used, not just to say 10, 15 pounds, up to, you know, whatever's reasonable in this area.
Well, we can find that out.
I can tell you an average when we do a standard relocation, by the room count, generally on a rental unit, it's probably about 2,000.
Oh, really?
Yeah, well, it depends how much stuff they, you know, the basement's full, the garage is full, the attic's full, it's a room count, but we haven't used those official room numbers when we've done incentives for tenants.
If I may add one more thing, I guess, for you or Mike, when we go down this path here to consider, I guess I'd like some sort of clause in there where, you know, people don't leave and just, since this place, we're vacating it and it's going to go by the wayside, that I can just damage as much of the place as I want. I mean, I don't want to see that. I don't know if I just made sense when I said I know what
I know, and I don't think anyone wants to see that. I don't know what kind of control we'd have on that, to be honest with you.
Well,
usually it's not damage. It's usually,
you know, we're going to give you this incentive to leave once you go, but if we go into the place and find out you purposely damaged
much
of it, you know, either no or a lesser amount.
Usually it's things left, you know, the couch is too heavy, I'm leaving it, you know.
That doesn't bother me. It's somebody who takes a sledgehammer to a water basin or a toilet.
Right. We have not ever had that happen, actually.
Can I ask you a rhetorical question? Why do you care for tearing it down?
Oh, I don't think it's just good practice with people to allow people to go unwantedly damage property. And that's a message that you shouldn't be doing it. And I have to go back because one time I dealt with rental property and have to clean up after people, so I'm a little bit jaded.
I guess I'd like some clarification with regards to the tenants. I mean, I don't know, for example, the income of the tenants that are living here. So are your incentives going to be based on income or just incentives to get the tenants out? You know, that those are some questions that I would have. You know, tenants inherently have their tenants there. You know, the owner could issue a 30-day notice at any point. So, you know, is income an issue with regards to whether or not they have the resources to move?
Well,
that's a little bit more work for us because we.
Unless the offer is 2 or 3 months of rental and relocating and mm-hmm. moving them. I mean, you move them and give them 3 months of rent, pay or board, you know, I mean, that's, I think. Is
right, because then, I mean, then we need to find out. We'll have to do some interviews to the of the tenants to find out income levels to see where they're at or if it's just going
to
be like carte blanche across the board.
That's starts to add up in my head. I mean, even if you gave $1,000 and if you gave 3 months rent, that's $2,500 per household. That's, I mean.
It almost seemed like you would want to use the incentive that you could be consistent from tenant to tenant so you're not having to vary based on this or very based on that. Kind of reminds me of when we redid the riders, you know. We went with length of season because it was the one consistent thing that we could use no matter what. Not whether I cared more about how I coached the sport or how much, you know what I'm saying? It's the one constant piece.
But the family size might be different. I mean, cost, mm-hmm. I mean, if we wanted to say we were going to do the, you know, theoretically, if you want an objective standard, you could theoretically use the household size as emergency assistance calculates, then you have an objective thing, be it 4, 5, or 6. I guess I have no, if we're going to be moving this forward to next week, I have no idea what we're, I mean, I had some ideas and there were several other ideas and I don't know where that leads us for next week.
What we're voting on is to pursue the property.
Yeah.
And I think we need to get more information before we come up with a concrete.
So we're not voting next week to exercise eminent domain? We're just voting to pursue or are we? Because there's 6 months from some kind of
vote.
Yeah,
the
city exercises.
We do.
You manage.
Correct.
Okay. So if we are working with a 6 month clock, then I guess my question is, are we voting to pursue or are we already pursuing because we're very serious about the idea and then next week we'll be doing it? That's.
Okay. Well, can I?
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, it seems Celestine is, you know, told us that you do a great job and she trusts you to do a great job and all those things. I know she's good. So to me it seems as if as a board we could trust the process a little bit and potentially vote to move forward and then have you, you know, do what you need to do in terms of the 6 month notice and those kinds of things and get the information that we need mm-hmm. to be able to determine the you know money because some of the tenants may just say great I'm out mm-hmm. you know
right.
I got a place
right.
and they don't really need any help and others may nor do they want it or you know and others may struggle and
mm-hmm.
really need a lot of help and I just
mm-hmm.
I don't know I'm in the position to say we don't have time to wait to not move forward with
right.
this and can we do that I look at the legal person over here
mm-hmm.
and look at it from a you know, come back to us with the information, and then we can make a decision about.
You know,
support.
The moving and relocating of the people inside the houses is secondary to the acquisition. So you have to the point of doing is of doing the taking is because you have to have all these properties. So you have to be able to start that acquisition process, which, you know, we have to go out, we have to get an appraisal, we have to make the offer, they get 60 days to get a second. You know, those, that's a whole process on the acquisition side, and then there's the tenant management and the owner relocation on the other side. So you don't want to hold things up for the acquisition, because that in itself is a lengthy process, because if at some point you go through the process and can't come to terms on that, you will have to issue a jurisdictional offer and start, you know, because most, I mean, I've only done a JO, I think, two times in the entire time I've been doing this. So usually you can come to terms when you negotiate, but you have to start that process, so there's a timeline to that, legally, so.
But it sounds like if I'm an owner,
mm-hmm.
If I'm an owner-occupier,
mm-hmm.
given that you only had to do a JO twice ever,
yep.
that means you're giving me probably a pretty good deal, because I almost always take it, right? So if I'm an owner-occupier, I'm going to come out of this with a profit.
Or you'll come out with a better living situation than you're
or, in. Or however I choose mm-hmm. to spend that, I'm going to end up with something mm-hmm. better, either equal and money or better and...
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm there haven't been any, no more than two landlord owners that have pushed you to the point where you had to do a JO either. So landlords are walking away pleased.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess you see my concern here.
I have to say, I don't think that. I mean, I understand what you're saying, but the truth of the matter is that tenants do not own property, and they don't get the benefit of property ownership, even. But regardless, but what the message I hear you saying is, and I think Mike and Alan and Melissa hear this, and Cheryl is hearing this as well, that we want to make sure in the acquisition of these properties for this school that we are doing the just thing for the tenants. We are going to do what is necessary to make those tenants, to give them a just situation, even though we don't have to.
I would be looking to provide them with something a little higher than merely just, but not jackpot either. I guess I'd like to see them get a good.
A couple things here. I've moved more than once in my life, and it always costs you more than you think it's going to. So I don't think anybody's going to come out with, the owner's going to come out with a bonanza by any means. The people that own this property, that are renting the property out, they now have lost income because they no longer have that property. So it's not like they're making a bonanza on this either. But I think Ms. Jeffrey said it very well in what we want to do.
I'm comfortable not having the details of what we want to do next week.
Right.
I'm comfortable
right.
having you come back in a month.
Yes.
I think we should move forward with it and then get the details as it rolls out.
The only property I'm concerned about is
the group home.
Being able to relocate that. That's not easy.
And it's not actually a designated CVRF, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So it's a place where people live, but it is not a designated community-based residential. I also feel like these are people, these are their lives. I don't know that we necessarily need to get into details of the open public meetings.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Right.
So, I mean, I think that moving forward, I think we can definitely say, we can do this next week. In addition to the fact that some of the misgivings that we're having and the wading into these waters for us as a board, all seven of us kind of new doing this, since it's been a while since we've done an acquisition, I think we need to talk about it a little bit more and sort of know our minds a little bit. And I don't know that we're coming to that right now. But I would say, yes, go ahead and get the, you know.
Well,
Well, we,
the dominoes.
What we could do is, you know, next week vote on pursuing the purchase, yeah, which would give the city, Cheryl, to get the wheels in motion.
Yeah,
and then if you wanted us, you know, Cheryl, if she's agreeable, in 3 months or so could come back and give a report saying, this is what I found. You know, this is, you know, these tenants are wanting to move. I have a tenant here that we have an issue with. And then if we want to decide that at that point, you know, to do something, we could.
I feel like the processes go together, because once you have voted on a taking, that, I guess that starts, that labels this project now.
Right, yeah.
So my contact with those tenants then will be giving them official notices. My contact with the owner will be an official notice saying,
right,
you know, yeah, we're interested in purchasing this,
yes,
property, et cetera, et cetera. So I don't know if I can come back in 3 months, which is too long, by the way, and
right,
And say, well, here's the situation, you want to go? Cause
yeah, no, yeah, no. I'm not,
I guess I'm confused
that,
with
yeah,
that.
I didn't mean
I'm thinking
to
we
go,
should go forward
if,
with
if
yeah,
we
if
find
do
a,
that.
I guess I didn't mean that we would,
oh, okay,
not go with them. I just say that we have a tenant here that we may have to give,
okay,
yes,
some help,
yeah,
okay,
assistance
that's,
to.
Because I'll just need to know what, you know, which ones we're going
to
go
yeah,
with.
We
and
to do.
The 6 month process needs to start.
Right,
yes.
That,
yes,
right, that's,
yeah, yeah.
Because we may run into like four tenants that are, okay, I have a place, and within a month or two, they're already
okay,
getting to move, but you
gotcha,
might run into one or two tenants that need some assistance, and we can come back and say, you know, would we assist them in these ways? And I don't know if that's 60 days or,
mm-hmm,
you know, how long that would process would be.
Okay. The only thing I ask, though, is if you're when you're voting on this or you're discussing those incentives, that you do that in closed session.
Yeah.
Because I don't want, I would prefer not to let the tenants know like
yeah,
what those incentives potentially
yes,
could
exactly,
be,
yes,
and I'm just going to write a check.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
So in the, I just want to clarify this because I've left a little uncertain. Are you saying that in the, typically when the notice has been given, have tenants, have you arranged for tenants, has the city paid tenants anything for relocation, or has that been on their own?
We have occasionally offered tenants incentives if they've had difficulty finding a place. But that's after a period of time. I mean, we usually sit down with the tenant and actually meet with them face to face and explain the situation. Give them the notice, you know, find out if they're going to need any help from us. I mean, to be honest with you, most tenants don't really like us being there as a municipality. So they're like, okay, thanks. And they go, so. There are a few that need our help, and that's when we look at the situation, we help them.
Well, nobody has, whether people have money saved or not, no renter has just extra money to do a move they don't want to do. Even if you're wealthy, you don't have, right? You're not whole. If I'm not whole, if you tell me I will be moving, and I'm going to have to get the stuff moved somehow, so I'm a little bit less than whole then, right?
Well, you know, I think, Andrew, I mean, I think that we understand that we're with you, but we need to start the process so that we can get those details and figure out what this all looks like. It makes me uncomfortable also to talk about what the tenants are going to do or not do when we don't even know who they are.
Right, I don't want to speculate their issues.
Well, and that's why I was trying to be careful to say whether a tenant is low income or even wealthy, you're still not whole if you have to move. But it sounds like moving expenses are a minority of the time that the city has given them. It's not often.
We've never given a tenant under the new state rule of moving expenses per se as the cost of, I mean, we've, how can I say this? I mean,
yeah,
they're tenants. It's a tenancy. So there's an expectation that they're it's not an ownership situation. So it's a tenancy. So, I mean, I think the fact that we go in and we tell tenants, look, we're going to purchase this property and you're going to need to move. They're like, oh, 30 days. We're like, no, you have 6 months and let us know if, you know, you have any issues. Oftentimes we've said we'll help you with a security deposit in the new place. So, you know what I mean? I don't know if it's a total. I mean, I think a lot of tenants are just happy that they have that extra time to help them move.
Yeah, I guess, you know, the fact that 6 months and you have to move is much less bad than what a private landlord could just impose if someone's on month to month. I don't like the whole less bad. Yeah, I don't like living up to a standard of less bad, but I'm certainly not suggesting that a renter would be entitled to something as generous or even close to as generous as an owner who's probably put money in and so forth. I get that. It's just that a 1 month of security deposit seems a little light, maybe when an owner is going to get a five-figure number plus the value of the property.
We don't know. Why don't we wait and see what...
Yeah, I need to really clarify, though. The relocation payments are reimbursable expenses, so those owners are going to have to buy something to get that benefit. The only money they could actually pocket would be if they choose a fixed moving payment, where we say, 10 rooms equals this amount of money, here's your check, move yourself. They could potentially pocket because they call their friends up, they make some chili, they move themselves. I need to clarify that. It's not like people who are being displaced and get relocation benefits are getting a windfall. They may be able to move into a better living situation, but they're going to have to buy that house, and then we're going to make those payments to them. So that's not like...
I was just looking at the theoretical maximum of $29,000.
Right, but they'd have to spend $29,000 to get it, is my point.
Okay, but it's a reimbursable. Okay, if you say I'm going to take the flat, it would be nowhere near...
No. That flat moving might be $2,500, and so they decide to move themselves.
Oh,
and
okay.
Which actually usually saves the city money, because if you were to hire a mover and pay for the reconnections of all those, it's actually a better deal if they take a fixed moving payment for whoever's doing that. But, if they're going to get $29,000, they're going to have to spend that either in a higher mortgage or something to that effect. I mean, they're going to have to spend that to get it. It's reimbursable, so.
But that would include spending on a higher value property, too.
Mm-hmm. If that's what they choose to do, yep.
Okay, so that's
or
still
the comp, so. You know what I mean? So I just want to clarify that, because it makes it sound like these owners get windfalls, and they really don't. But sometimes they're able to go into a better living situation than what they have.
I'm not that worried about how this ends. Mm-hmm. I'm worried about what am I saying yes to next week. Because I think what I'm saying yes to, I think I have to be convinced that all hypotheticals are covered. And it's not a trust issue, I think you're right that we shouldn't, start speculating numbers too far and
right.
Open session and
but we do need to get the process started. So the vote next week will be
to acquire. Otherwise, we've done nothing with the 6 month clock.
Right. We need to acquire to get the 6 month.
And next week we have an answer on that one property, 222.
No, I don't think we have an answer on it, but I guess that once Cheryl starts working with the people, if we determine that it's
because
not something that we want to pursue,
okay.
Then
it's
we
not
just
a
won't.
Question mark. It's on the list.
It's on the list now,
okay.
But if we determine that it,
honestly,
we don't want to do it, then we just won't pursue it. Right.
Would there be any benefit, and I'm not talking dollar amounts or anything, but would there be any benefit, and Cheryl, you probably have a lot of experience, in terms of defining some key principles that the board would want to address? So, for example, we would support this, we wouldn't support this, and frame it, not an amount, not, because we can't address all the hypotheticals, because who knows, but if the board... if this, then this kind of thing, and we would want to pay this expense if this occurred, or this expense, and then you kind of lay out a framework
mm-hmm.
of what people typically do.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not the walk away with nothing, is that even possible to generate some key principles?
I could give it a shot if,
would that
for example,
help?
If you have, I'd have to think of the situations. Because the bottom line is you need the tenants out at 6 months.
Correct.
Because you need to remove the structures and start the process along. So we'd have to set something up to say, if tenants aren't out at 6 months or something.
I don't know. I'm trying to think of how we do that.
I mean, the phrase that comes to mind is no worse off.
Whatever
that means, but no worse off, you know, doesn't mean I got my security deposit covered and I'm moving. May not mean I got security deposit taken care of and had to move all my stuff myself. I don't think you're probably that much better off. But again, that's hard to speculate here. I just, the thought that came into my mind is no worse off, because the owner won't be anywhere close to worse off. I mean, they will be clear cut better off, no doubt about it. But you know, if it's determined that a renter doesn't need X, a renter can certainly be left worse off, even if we find them a place. They could be worse off financially. I don't want to leave anyone worse off.
Yeah, if I may, the assumption that the homeowner is going to be better off, I don't think is necessarily a correct one, because while you can make somebody whole relatively well financially, in terms of memories and other stuff that goes, the change is not easy. May I ask the question, you guys understand what some of the concerns are here and work with them as best you can and bring it back?
Yep.
Is that?
I guess, but there would have been more than two JOs if people have memories they work that into their negotiation. I mean, if people were dissatisfied left and right, you'd have more.
Right, people finding
it. You don't, so they're.
Yeah, but you know, I tell you, I seem to recall someone trying to negotiate a higher price, and it just didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't happen. Here's the price. This is the fair market value for this property. Take it or leave it. My recollection is that they took it. So,
but leave it. I mean, that means challenging in court, right?
Correct. And I mean, that's a little guidance I'm going to need to receive from this body with regards to the ability to negotiate on the properties, and that's certainly something we want to do in closed session.
We'll discuss when we get the ball rolling.
You know, when I purchased with the Redevelopment Authority, for example, they gave me parameters as a person with regards to my negotiation abilities. So that's something we'd look at. But right, there are some people that just are like, no, I'm not selling, I don't care what the price is. And those are the times that actually, those are the two times we've had to do the JOs where there was no negotiating at all. It's a principle.
Okay.
All right.
Let's move this
forward. Anything else?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Cheryl.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Don't skipping out of here.
She's skipping out of here.
She's skipping out of
here. Oh, it was still much more pleasant than my experience.
Oh, all right. Good to see you.
Sorry.
Okay, now we'll move ahead to human resources, where we will start off with handbook updates.
We have two important considerations before you. The one that was brought up with the comments that you heard a month ago or so, and the comments today, really are surrounding the process. And we've already begun to look at the process, to work on that, and I feel confident that the process issues can be resolved and improved upon, because they are very important. The other consideration is separate, and that really is the belief or the philosophy of hiring the most qualified applicant and also opening up our applicant pool and getting an earlier start on our applicants. This would be for all of the units, not just the educator unit, but all the units. And so we are bringing forward the recommendation as it was last month, hopefully with greater understanding and our ability to respond to the questions that you have tonight, both on the process side as well as the impact it will have, the change we have on our staff and our principals and supervisors. So with that, I would entertain any questions that you have. If you have any comments, Michelle, that you wanted to make. But I think this would be a good time to make sure you have all your questions answered and be prepared to do that.
Okay. Questions? Chris?
There are several concerns raised at the last meeting. how does that fit in with what we have here? How are they addressed, those concerns? I can appreciate there may not be total agreement by any means on some of these issues, but again, how are those addressed?
The issues, as I recall, really centered a great deal around communication and getting back to people in a timely manner, if they received the position, why they weren't interviewed. And what we would propose is we have a very decentralized employment process. We would create, we already have a process in place. We would educate all of our leaders on that process and make sure that there are timelines in terms of getting back to people and how people should be contacted. Another consideration was the posting of the process. And tomorrow I'll be rolling out the staffing request to the principals and leaders, asking that they send that request to Human Resources, and then we will have a turnaround in posting the job within 24 hours on a business day, and that job would be posted. All of our jobs are actually available right on our district website. If you're on the home page and you look in the lower right-hand corner, and you can click in there, and you can see all the jobs posted. So you don't have to go to Weekend to see them. So it's quite easy to, if we post the jobs, they'll be there. And then if a person wants to apply for it, they can go to WeCamp. If they just want to look at the position, and they can do that as well. So we already have that in place. So I think it's a matter of making sure that people know how to access the jobs from our district homepage. And then we also are, as Cheryl said, we're also going to be doing a presentation this month to all of the units who represent, who sit on the labor management, and show them how WeCan works. And then we'll have classes for people who, all of our employees, about WeCan and how to set up a profile and apply. We also can make the application for internal people on WeCan easier and more straightforward than the one that exists for the external candidates. It can be just a couple pages of the essential information that we need. We don't have to require a resume or a cover letter. And the one for the external candidate would require more information.
I think if I could add to that, I think a lot of the process questions that have come up in the last weeks really can be addressed well in labor management. I thought our meeting went well, and I thought they were very good questions, concerns in terms of how things are monitored, is the language, what does it really mean to bring further clarity around different things. We talked about how we can make it easier for staff by even putting the link to the jobs on the staff scoop. I mean, I think there's a lot of things we can do with the process questions that really reflect that we value our internal employees. And I think that's an ongoing concern that we've talked a fair amount about, is how can we, so that people recognize that they are going to be very viable candidates for these jobs and should in fact be considered. And I think that question was raised again, how will we monitor that and have that, you know, to ensure that our internal candidates are receiving full consideration. I know one of my questions of the group even that morning was, if I'm an employee internally and I've gone out to WeCan for the first time, how do I know my application got where it needed to be so that I would even be considered?
And there is a response that you get.
Right, and so those are the kinds of really, I think, important questions that we can address collectively through the labor management as they come forward, because it is a change of practice. And also, if there are concerns as they come up with the processes, I know you're going to work with management in that group, but I do think it's also a change of practice for them as well, which really means that we need to monitor that closely as well.
Jean, how more complicated does it, or cumbersome does it make things if you were, rather than just posting the jobs on the website, to continue to do the district-wide email? Is that...
We would like to, we would be doing it quite frequently, because what we've been doing now is we're waiting for a listing of jobs to come forward, and then pushing them out. Now, you'll see jobs that come out one by one right now, because we don't have as many openings. But during
right.
the high hiring seasons, we've been waiting and then putting them out.
We've been grouping
in
them.
This way, we'd like to put them out as they come in. So if one came in and we were ready, we just, the people who are collecting the staffing requests would be putting them out constantly. So that as soon as they came into HR, Pat would put one out, Tina could put one out, Sharon. So if we did that, we would be doing a lot of emailing to people. The upside of that is, well, they are going to be on that list that's already on the website. So people could check that out, and we can put the link in the staff scoop. If we waited, then the jobs are delayed, you know, to get posted. So we could do that, but then, you know, if a job came in on Monday, we could post on like Tuesdays and Thursdays, but I'd like to see it posted as they come in.
I agree that you know, the sooner
day.
You can get them posted, I think that's in everybody's yeah. best interest.
Mm-hmm.
But is it a hardship to just, when you write up the posting for the website, to just shoot it to everybody, or is I'm not, I guess,
well, you'd be doing a lot of them.
And
I mean, you'd be
lot.
Doing a lot of
and
emailing.
I
mean,
get a lot of them. I don't need to see.
Yeah, and
I
there's no way to there's no way to narrow it down to the
you
unit
can't filter.
Right.
Okay.
So what about is there a certain minimum length of time that postings stay valid?
There is. It's 5 days, and we're looking now to make sure they cross over a weekend.
A weekend.
So that, you know, people
looking to, or we will do that.
We will do that.
Yeah.
Okay. And we have, that's
we,
a practice you've been doing for quite some time.
So
but
you could, I don't,
Friday,
but I mean, people
we can't do it.
Shouldn't be dependent, we shouldn't be dependent on a person's level of internet access at home, but if you're always including a weekend,
mm-hmm.
could you do a twice a week consolidated email?
We could.
I mean, because we have, I know at my company, there's a Friday email, and we know what's open. It may have gotten posted a few days earlier, but I'm going to at least have Friday to read it and decide.
Yeah, you would always have a weekend to read it.
If the communications would put a live link that carries through from every edition of Staff Scoop that would take people there, two things would happen. It would trigger, if I want to look, it's alive, I can go right to the site.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would know that for sure they would have the weekend if it's something they hadn't seen or heard about.
Yeah.
That's
yes.
how I'm thinking it
mm-hmm.
could work well.
Yes.
But why not list, the jobs? Otherwise, you know, I mean, you could describe them.
It's all on the list. All
but
I have to do is hit
staff
a button.
Scoop. So we don't get Staff Scoop, do we?
Mm-hmm.
We get individual posting.
So there's
yes.
a list of the jobs in Staff Scoop?
We would put
a
the link,
link
there.
If you look.
And then I'll just have to guess. I guess I'm saying there's a link, and so I'm just going to guess every week that maybe there's something in my unit. Why wouldn't you just have a list? Is it a hardship to have the list go out weekly plus a link?
Well, the link would take you to the list.
It would take
right.
you right to the
but
list.
But the link,
yeah.
right, but it wouldn't list any of the jobs.
Yeah, no,
yeah
it
does.
It
lists
would.
All the jobs.
The
email would not contain the
jobs.
The Staff Scoop doesn't have
but
the jobs.
But all I have to do is click it. It's
yeah.
alive.
If you go on the internet right now, you can click in the lower right-hand corner. You can see all the jobs that are posted.
Sure, but I don't know. Should I have to be doing that every single week? If nothing, even remotely, that I'm qualified for is out there, why not just have it in the email?
Well to that argument is why I don't want to see all these emails coming at me.
I just said once a week. What's the problem with a once a week email that includes a list?
But our Staff Scoop is where we're trying to get all of our staff to go once a week to read about what's happening in the district. Whether it's jobs or something from technology, or that's where we've been really trying hard, because communication is one of those things we're always getting feedback on. We're trying to get our staff to realize that every Friday that staff scoop comes out, that's where everything is going in one spot. So if I went there every week, like I'm hoping, like we're hoping they would, all they'd have to do is click on the link and it would be there. And
so we're wanting that to be the clearinghouse instead of a weekly email be the clearinghouse.
That is a week, that is the weekly email.
Right, but it's a weekly email of a link.
No, there's a lot of other stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, so why can't one of the other stuff be a list of these are the new positions we open?
Call in Lori.
I think we can address Andrew's issue. I mean, I think what you're looking for, Andrew, is so this week's job postings, food service, right?
Yeah.
Service, positions at Fred Smith, blah, blah, blah.
It just doesn't seem, if we're doing an email anyways, I just don't, I mean, if there's a hardship to putting a list of the open jobs, tell me. I don't want to create a hardship. It just doesn't seem like that much of a...
I think the difference would be if it's now versus in the heat of the positions changing, right? So if it's just a matter of us listing four or five name, you know, position titles, because that's what I was yesterday. Following positions are open, so if, like, food service has a food service work position, and then they would know that when they click on the link, those are the positions they see. I think the bigger challenge is in the middle of all of the changes that we have, if there's 50 teaching positions open, you know, but I think that's the time most people, at least educators, know if you're looking, because that's when...
Right, and that's where you send them in this.
I'm not quite sure what you're asking for.
Yeah, because you're asking for a list, but if you go to the staff scoop, you click the link and you have a list.
So this is what, I don't see, if someone is...
No, Andrew, answer my question. What are you looking for?
A list of the open positions once a week.
Click it on.
So you're looking for a list of open positions to be sent to employees instead of employees going to a place and finding that list.
I don't think it's unreasonable to have a list of the job titles so they know if it's worth their time.
Sent to the employees versus the employees going to look for the list. That's what you're asking for.
Yes. So they're not... I mean, we've done it, but it's a consolidated version of what we've done all along.
But the problem is this, right? Okay. I'm a little bit more interested in the staff members who don't have email, who don't have computers at home, especially some of our custodial staff and perhaps some of our monitors, and maybe paras, I'm not sure, who are not physically at their computer all day like some of the teaching staff. I'm a little bit more concerned about those people and how they get the listings as opposed to someone who has that computer access. I just went on. Actually, I have actually directed people to our, to gbabs.org, and I say, okay, click here, and then skip the weekend stuff and just click and look at the list, and then you can decide whether or not you want to open up an account, or if you have an account, you can actually go in and apply. So I'm a little bit, I have to say, I'm not with you. I am interested in talking about people who may not have that access, and so how do they find out, where do they get access? Maybe it's simple. But if you've got a computer, click, you're in. You have the list already. And so NWTC.
Where's the harm, though? Because it makes life a little bit easier for employees to know if it's worth their time.
I'm sorry, Andrew, not really.
What? It's not.
No. I've been having it on my phone. Click, done. There it is. It actually isn't easier.
The staff scoop comes out in an email to staff.
Yeah, so they get the email.
The hiring update will be click here if you think maybe you want a job. Click here if you want a job. Right? It will not say elementary teacher position open.
It will after you click.
You click once, you got the
girls,
whole
JV
list.
Soccer coach,
Lori,
Spanish social worker.
Could you pull up the district's website
so
we can show
click, you're in.
I'm in.
Your point is well taken about people who don't have...
I'm worried about that.
They wouldn't get the emails.
No,
either.
Right.
Why is it important to not have the link and the list? Why is that important to not have both?
Why bother? When you've got the links.
It's more work.
Because it's just one more little thing that we're taking away.
It would be one more thing that
we have to maintain, because this already is working, and many
right,
people
yeah.
do use this.
So wait, I'm going to take you and raise you one even better.
Okay.
So now, when you are looking at, you're in an organization the size of ours, right? And given the fact that we've been talking about, you know, having the best employees, part of getting great employees is having our own employees get other great employees. I don't think that not getting the list prevents our current employees from then saying, hey, there's a social world, like I said to you about my friend's daughter, who's a registered dietitian, about to be. Hey, there's a job at Green Bay. Click, click, here you go. Here's the link. My own, when we're doing these listings, I just want to make sure that we can have an environment where our employees feel it's very easy for our employees to say, hey, I know that there's a job, I think you'd be great for it, why don't you apply? That is what I want to continue to foster. But I'm sorry, I'm not with you on the sending them a list when they can get the link.
Okay, but I'm not clicking, I for sure, right, here's the best situation. I'm happy with my job, I'm not looking.
Okay.
If I'm not looking, my day is pretty full and busy. Now you're talking about our employees finding other good people. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna have a lot more things on my plate than to check every week for the potential that there might be an opening for a friend of mine, right?
No, because what you do is you send the link to your friend and say, who's looking for a job, click here. Or I heard, you know, like I know that we're looking for school psychologists. I actually just had a conversation with somebody about school psychologist positions. So,
well, you do now.
Are they applying?
No, she's not ready. But yes, sorry, I didn't mean to get your hopes up.
Good try.
Right, but I mean, okay, sure. I may tell. There's a difference though between telling friends hypothetically, "Hey, be sure to click on Green Bay every week." I'm gonna, you know, if I see that, and I see tennis
yeah.
coach. I might pick up the phone, but I'm not going to call.
But you're going to
see an email.
You just
staff scoop is an email. You
they
open
send.
That email, mm-hmm. you push the link, and you get
and
this.
Yeah.
Right, but why am I going to push the link if I'm happy with my job?
Why are you going to open your email if you're happy with your job?
Because I was just told that staff scoop is this one-stop information for everything important going on in the district. Right? So I should be, there's going to be stuff in staff scoop of interest to me, whether or not I'm looking for work, if that's
true.
Correct. That staff
right.
scoop is
true.
Much more than a job posting, right?
Correct.
Right, but I'm saying, why would you open that second email that you're asking them to send if you're not looking for a job? You wouldn't open that email,
so I would
and
see
you
the,
wouldn't you wouldn't click the link.
But you know someone looking for a job, send them the link.
With the link,
and then they continue to look.
The equivalent of 25 emails
and
one
list. And then the teacher next door who is looking for a job tells you, hey, I know your friend is looking for the network operations manager job. Why don't you?
I just think you're making a big deal out of not doing something that would be much better than what, much less work right now, which is every posting to everybody on the day it comes out.
Well, Lori showed you is every time we post something to WeCan, it goes on that list. So it's in there right away. I've never, in all my experience in HR, I've never had a situation where we push jobs out. But I've never also had a situation where employees didn't go and look. Everybody likes to look at what the job openings are in most cases. Some people don't. So if this was in staff scoop, we want everybody to read that every week because there's valuable information in it. Many, many people will decide to look at that even if they're not looking.
I think more will look
they
than
will,
did in the
I
past.
Think they'll look at it more than these emails that we're sending out all the time.
Which I ignore.
You know, that it's, you know, It doesn't say what it is really, and many people ignore those. I'm more worried about that being ignored than this, which is you open it up
and you
it's
can
very
have
clean.
The best of both worlds. You could copy paste that onto the bottom of staff scoop. But you know what, there's There's bigger.
It's on staff skills.
Honestly, it's a link that's alive. There's no need to print a list. This is a better list.
You're not deleting 20 emails that have been sent out on these vacancies.
Right, but you're either not. I'm talking about adding a copy paste of that onto the end of one staff scoop email every week. But I have, bigger fish to fry than that.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm sure you do. So let's move on.
I am worried about the people who can't check. Are people allowed to read staff scoop on the clock?
Oh yes.
Sure.
Even if they don't have a break, if they're a 3-hour position, they can stay 15 minutes and read staff scoop on the clock.
You bring up an important point. We need to make sure.
Well, this staff scoop is work. Yep. We put this out there because we think this is information that is important for people to know. Okay. It's going to provide you all the updates that you know. It's not the, you know, for sale information. It's information you need to know. And so we are, you know, Michelle has messaged to people, staff scoop, it came out in one of your phone updates, that is the location for our information. Right. So when you're on the call, when you're reading that,
So if I'm a 2-hour employee who doesn't have a break, mm-hmm. and I'm just working lunchroom 11 to 1, mm-hmm. and I have a 2-hour position, within reason, I can take 15 minutes and I can punch out at 1:15 instead of 1 and say it was because I was reading staff scoop and I won't be questioned?
I would have to make sure that there isn't time during your day to do it.
So if I don't have a break, though, mm-hmm. that's a problem.
If they don't have a break and they don't have access, how are they looking at the jobs that are being sent out to them every day?
That's also a problem.
I think what I would offer is this. We can speak to our principals about it, express the concern that was brought to this table. Mm-hmm. I think it's a very real concern that we want to make sure that everyone has access, and they need to go back in their buildings and look at and see if there are people who don't, and if for those people they need to work something out.
How long is staff scoop normally?
It takes me about 3 minutes unless I read all the technology.
How many pages
stuff?
Could we have
one.
A certain number of hard
it's, copies? It's one, but you can click through different things and read things more in depth if you want to.
Let me ask Diane a technology question. So if I am a substitute food service worker, can I get access to a computer at school,
yes.
even after I'm done?
They have a login.
Okay.
They have a login.
Do they know they have permission to go into a computer lab unoccupied and do it?
We have designated areas in a lounge where teachers have access to things, or there's libraries that have open admin computers that are designated for teacher use only.
Including subs, part-timers, everyone. Mm-hmm. Everybody know if I walked in and asked 20 sub food service workers tomorrow, do you know you can check the newsletter? 19 of them would say yes. I go to the library.
Well, I think with our new absence system, that's web based and ASOP, and they've had to navigate that in order to get their absences. So
with all the people are coming through new employee orientation now, and they are getting one of the first parts of it is to show them their email address and their login,
mm-hmm.
and we make sure they have a computer in front of them and they can bring it up. And
at that time we're telling them that if you're a sub, you can feel free to check your account. In fact, we want you to
check your emails. Yep.
And then another question. So, can I sign up at weekend for an alert to let me know when a job that I'm looking for has become available?
I don't believe that's a feature of weekend.
No.
I do think there's a feature in weekend, though, that allows you to select like an area of the state and a particular teacher or a particular grouping, and you can get alerts for that. Okay.
And is it email alerts? I mean, I'm asking a deep question. Email or text?
Oh, I don't
I don't think you get alerts. I think you go and you create a filter.
We can check into that. I think that there's capabilities where you can, once you set your profile, that you can get dinged on openings.
Because then that would help people who may not have that access at home.
We can get an email alert.
You also have the capability, and we can, to apply for any openings that come available within your certification. So you kind of do this broad application, and then it autofills when positions become available based upon your certification. We have many of the same administrators that apply for every position, and you can see as soon as it goes, it's autofilling those applicants.
Uncertified staff too can do this? If I'm food service, can I blanket apply to all?
We can double check for you. I don't know if the capability is different.
If you can blanket apply, now all of a sudden I feel a lot better because you can register and stuff comes up and you get a phone call about it because you've applied.
We do need to help people negotiate that initial.
We're going to have a class. Tina Novak is the guru of WeCan, and she'll offer classes to people. Plus, if somebody is struggling, we have a computer in human resources that people can sit down and we can step them through the process if they need to.
Okay.
I just had a technical question based on, I think it was Karen Stibbs who said at the open forum, and I think it's just a clarification more than anything, because the my understanding of the job shadowing is that the job shadowing occurs while you still hold your position.
Correct.
And so you're not going to job shadow, giving up your position, and then having it disappear while job shadowing.
That's correct.
The idea is that their position is held until they decide to take the new job, and they might choose to job shadow before they decide to take the new job.
Yes.
Okay. And so their position actually doesn't disappear because of a bad job shadow.
That's right.
It would disappear because they took a new job and then you filled it with someone else.
Yes.
Okay. I'll call myself. Katie?
Yes.
Karen's point is well taken, that how do you shadow a vacant job?
Well, there's always somebody, unless it's a brand new job that's not been filled, there's always a sub in the position that you can, so for example, if it's a clerical position, somebody's in that position doing that job, unless it's brand new. Now, the sub may not be the person that knows the job to the extent that the previous person knew it, but you can at least see, you know, where, if it's a clerk, where you sit. You know, you can talk with the people around you. You can see what are the duties during that portion of the job shadow. And a job shadow is just to give you an idea of what that job is like. It isn't, because there are things, you know, you do on a monthly basis that may not come up, and there's always unusual things that happen in every job. But to give you just an idea of, here's what I'm going to do. It's going to be especially important, I think, with paraprofessionals, where you're moving to a position to work with a particular student who might have certain needs that you may think, well, this would be great, and then you get there and you realize that it's much more involved than you thought. And so that's that, and it might be that you're going to talk with the teacher who oversees the student as well as the person caring for the child as well. So that it's when you're moving from a job that's very different from what you're currently doing, that's really important.
In the case of an opening, so a person left the position and there's a sub, we've even been creative to have the person go to another seasoned person in a different building so they could really understand, or have that person come over to the building. So I think the goal is that we want to put the person in a position to be successful. Right. How we do that is what I believe that we're committed to doing. And the principals are also pushing us for that. They're realizing that the more that they get the folks onboarded, the more successful they're going to be, and that's just a better, more successful relationship.
Do you think if the person who had the job has transferred to another job in the district, the person considering the job can always call him or her and ask, you know, how was the job? Why did you leave the job? And talk with them. If they've moved out of the district, it would be more difficult, but still possible.
But they maintain their position of record.
Well, the job shadow.
Oh,
their
shadow.
The shadow will only be a few hours. I mean, this is, and yes, this is, the shadow is part of the application process.
But they, all the questions and whatnot, they
can
pursue.
And they have the right to shadow, to have a sub called in while they're shadowing.
Well, we'll have to, well.
Not at the moment of their choosing, but they will have the right to, within reason, shadow. I mean, probably not request a shadow every single day just to.
Right, there has to be some reasonableness to it.
I think you would have to have applied, show that you're serious.
Yes.
I guess, you know, again, here, these, you know, these things that are debatable whether they're low or high impact, that I'm concerned might have an impact on staff morale. Like, for example, right now you have what's, yes, is generous, more so than other places, much more generous than other places. You have a 5-day trial period, which is a bit of a, I'm sure if I were in your chair, I would consider that a moderate headache. 5-day trial periods, because it can cause cascading problems. I get that.
It's more than that,
yeah.
Though, Andrew. Principals have reported having these positions open and not being able to fill, and the lack of continuity or ability to hire, and losing your staff person. So it's more than just an HR.
It's not an HR issue.
Okay,
it's not problematic for human resources at all.
It's for the buildings.
It is feedback directly from buildings. It's regarding the kids.
But the
it's not HR.
You could,
I can do it.
You could go from 5 to 3. You could go from 5 to 2.
Where the trial period became problematic this year became real evident at the end of the school year last year. We had open positions in our support staff, our 10-month positions. They interviewed, were awarded positions in June. They finished their school year. They couldn't start the trial period until September. So we were not able to post their positions until September. So for 90 days, we sat with vacant positions pending the trial period occurring. It happened in multiple positions that we had to leave open, which made that the position being filled ultimately pushed off until about November, where we could have had all of June, all of July, and all of August to fill all those positions, but the trial period prevented us from having that opportunity. That's the place where it causes the most problems from our standpoint, that we're not getting regular employees in front of our in our buildings at the start of the school year because the trial period is delaying that process for us.
Yes, if they transfer and it doesn't work, what is, we will work with them to facilitate and move to a more suitable position. That means it sounds like you're saying we will probably find you something.
And we have done that already. We've had situations that a person was beyond the trial period, it extended beyond it, and we're not comfortable, it wasn't successful for them, and we've worked with them to find another place for them to go to. Their old position was way beyond available any longer, but we were able to find a spot for them to go that they were comfortable with, and they continue to be employed by the district and are more successful in the place that they are now than where they were before.
In all cases?
We have not had one yet where we've had an employee and a supervisor who came to us, said that they're concerned with the placement for this person. Can we work it out? We've been successful in every one of those in finding a place that was a good fit for both.
Okay. So I guess, anyone else? I guess my last thing, this has come up more than once, and for me to vote, I'm gonna make this as an amendment next week, and if it's not in there, then I'll just have to vote no on the whole thing. I do feel really strongly that we need to have, this proposes to eliminate all preference for internal candidates, all formal preference. I think it is very little hardship to say that the most senior applicant, the most senior internal applicant will be interviewed. If there is an internal applicant, one or more, you will interview one. You cannot go all outside.
I would support that amendment.
And the worst case scenario on that is perhaps our principal has to do one more interview than they wish.
I think I would support that.
I'm concerned though, because every time it just seems every year we take a little bit more back and say trust us, and it usually works pretty much fine, but I'm always looking out for the time that it's not. And I don't want to hear, and it seems pretty likely I'll be around for a few more years probably. I really don't want to ever hear about, well, sometimes it's not a good idea to, you know, it's always a good idea to at least interview one. It's a morale disaster if you interview all externals. I think there's going to be a morale problem that they can interview one internal and four externals, even if it's a very early vacancy. I hope it doesn't happen very often, but I mean, that will need to be there, and I'll make that amendment next week.
Yeah.
Okay.
Anything else? I think it makes sense.
Okay. Last item, district's workers' compensation agent.
Yes, next week we'll bring forward to you a recommended motion to change our worker compensation broker from ANSI and Associates to M3. We feel that M3 will provide a better integration of worker compensation with our health plan, and will provide a lot more assistance with us and helps in terms of helping us lower our worker compensation costs. I outlined a few more points in the memo, but if you had questions, I'd be happy to entertain them.
Questions? This is an administrator change that's cost neutral?
Yes.
Well, and it may even be cost benefit?
Well, we hope so in terms of reducing the cost of worker comp.
Right.
You know, we use M3 for our insurance, and so now we'll be able to work together. There'll be a separate agent working with us on the worker compensation side, but it will help us integrate the insurance with the worker comp.
Questions? All right, and that concludes operational support.
All right, thank you, Andrew. We do have a closed session, so I read that motion. Closed session has been scheduled for Monday, January 12th, immediately following the adjournment of the work session meetings. Pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851C, considering employment, promotion, compensation, or performance evaluation data of any public employee over which the governmental body has jurisdiction or exercises responsibility, and pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851F, considering financial, medical, social, or personal histories and disciplinary data of specific persons, preliminary consideration of specific personnel problems, or the investigation of charges against specific persons, except for paragraph B applies, which if discussed in public would be likely to have a substantial adverse effect upon the reputation of any person referred to in such histories or data involved in such problems or investigations, to wit, personnel matters. Pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851G, conferring with legal counsel for a governmental body who is rendering oral or written advice concerning strategy to be adopted by the body, I just lost my mic, with respect to litigation in which it is or is likely to become involved, to wit, potential litigation matters, and pursuant to Wisconsin Statute 19.851E, deliberating or negotiating the purchasing of public properties, investing of public funds, or conducting other specified public business whenever competitive or bargaining reasons require a closed session, more specifically, to wit, potential contracts. The meeting will begin in open session to consider the appropriate motion for a closed session so provided by law.
So moved.
Second.
Sandy?
Becker?
Aye.
Aye.
Hi. All right, carried 7-0. We'll move across the hall.
Tomorrow.